hot time tonight.
Welcome to the October 8, 2012 Selectmen's Meeting. Special meeting at 6 o'clock. Please join me with a salute to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Well, we are going to start with the 2013 DPW budget. Do we want to discuss this before, pretty hard to...
I don't see how we can do it.
You'd like me to go make a panic phone call?
That's Fred, and maybe, but the only thing, if Fred's not here, like, for example, the way I looked at it, organized things, was I did according to the budget, I had DPW budget first, then I had DPW CIP, in which case any of my comments related to DPW warrant articles showed up there. And then the third piece that I have is just warrant articles that were unrelated to DPW. We could certainly talk about those, but that's not worthwhile until Fred's here.
Right.
So, I don't know. If
you want the next phone call, I guess, questions?
Well, the thing is, maybe he thinks it's at 7 o'clock.
I don't know if he thinks that. I know we talked about it. Was that 6?
There he is.
Yeah, no.
Here's another... late arrival.
Before when people aren't here that something's happened.
Okay. Well, why don't you go make it, and we'll talk about the warrant articles a little bit. Do you have any of the warrant articles you'd like to talk about, Ben? Ooh. Or Mike?
We can talk about the ones that aren't DPW as far as I'm concerned.
Mm-hmm.
Getting through this package and organizing them in some fashion is not going to necessarily be easy.
Mr. Chairman, I would make a motion until Mr. Welch comes down here. We did commence the meeting, a motion to adjourn momentarily until Fred comes back down here. Get a second on that?
Yeah,
sure.
Second.
Sure. All those in favor?
Thank you.
Yeah,
look at
my comment.
Did I miss anything?
Pledge. And we're still on.
Yeah, I know. Thank you. No, I do have some things I want to say about warrant articles, but wasn't really quite organized when I first sat down. Sorry. Should have been here a little bit earlier. 6 o'clock doesn't work well for meetings for me. That's all I can say.
Okay, we are back, and we are going to, do you want to do the warrant articles or the consent agenda?
First.
First. Why don't you start with the warrant articles? You said you had something to say.
Well, we can do the consent agenda, get that out of the way if you'd like, Mr. Chairman. Whatever's good.
Okay, the consent agenda for 2012, November 6th, election warrant, previously approved property tax agreement, previously approved deed waiver, and Thompson Elementary School, North Andover, Mass. Permission to park at Place Cove.
I'll make the motion to a consent, it's just that I'd like to discuss something after we get a second on that.
You second?
Okay. I'd like to, the permission to park at Place Cove, haven't they done that in the past?
They have, but they, since they don't have stickers, they've been getting tickets.
Okay.
So they would like permission from the board, which in essence is a waiver, to allow them to park there from 9:30 a.m. to 2 p.m. or being able to have an elementary school class on the beach itself to teach students what's in tidal pools and things of that nature.
That's that little parking area up about four or five blocks on the right as you're going north on Ocean Boulevard from High Street, right?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Sounds good to me.
I have a question. The items 2 and 3, previously approved property tax payment and deed waiver, when did we approve that?
I believe you approved that when the tax collector was here, but I don't think they've been signed. I think that's the problem with them. Let me just look. Deed waiver. That was for a property at 296-139-1. Waiving the period of time for the collection of the tax of 2009 taxes.
It says 27 River Ave. I don't remember that. That doesn't mean, I mean,
okay,
so
I
nine
remember
there
this one,
doesn't mean
I
don't. Does anybody remember?
Yes, we already did this because I know the name.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. That's fine.
Yeah. So, any other questions about that? All those in favor? Unanimous. I know those people.
Okay.
We've
done them before.
So now we're going to move on to the discussion of the warrant articles. Did you want to open that up, Mike?
Oh, sure I can. Let me flip over to the warrant articles. I flipped through them, and I had a couple of questions just to get the ball rolling here, and I might have more as we go along. But starting with, they're not page number, but it's quite a ways through the packet. It's the sewer connection fees. I had a question about that because I'm not familiar with what the sewer connection fee in the past has been. Is that $100 per each connection before, and we want to change it now to $300? I'm a little confused about the warrant article itself.
The sewer ordinance, which is controlled by town meeting,
okay,
has a fee of $100 to connect to the sewer system.
Okay.
What we're saying is that the actual administrative costs and everything else that go into actually connecting and doing the inspections and so forth cost the town about $300 to do that at this point.
Okay.
The $100 fee was put in 1948.
Okay.
So we're thinking that we need to increase that fee to at least today's costs.
Yeah.
So that we're not getting behind every time we connect a sewer system.
So that you, so this warrant article then wants to change it from $100 to $300.
That's
basically
correct.
Why is it to me that seems kind of fuzzy that that's what you want?
Because it's just a draft. I mean, we're trying to get the idea across that and find out whether or not the board would be in favor of something of that nature.
Oh, I have no problem with that. I was just looking at your draft and I was saying, I better ask a question about that because it's kind of fuzzy. It does say that the bottom line there says $300 per year, the time of application, and that doesn't... To me, it didn't mean you're going to change the fee from $100 to $300. You're just going to charge $300 per unit at the time of application. And that was kind of fuzzy to me.
Okay.
So I guess for me, and then trying to look at it as what I think would be sort of an average view by taxpayers, we may have to smooth that up a bit.
We didn't put the full language in to reflect what was in the ordinance, but
okay,
we will do that if the board wishes to move forward with the article.
Well, I think it's a good idea by itself. So that's one that's down for me.
Does anyone else want to discuss that particular one?
Staying on that one, it does, you know, the original $100 appears to have been 1948 on or about. But what we're modifying is Article 7 of the 1963 warrant.
That's correct.
And it does say to enact the following new article and fees for sewer connections, and then you skip down to the 300.
Right.
Was the 63 still at 100?
Yes, it was. It's never been changed since 48.
Were there other fees involved as well?
No, there weren't.
Okay.
There's no...
So instead of all the language that Mike's just spoken about, can we just say that we're going to modify whatever... doesn't go to any ordinance that we have. This goes back to the...
It actually goes to the sewer ordinance.
Okay, so we're going to modify the sewer ordinance then by establishing a fee of $300
per... And we'd have to put the language in to reflect that particular section of the sewer ordinance, and we'd have to duplicate the wording that's in the existing ordinance and change the 100 to 300.
That's what you're going to do with this?
Yes.
I'm happy with the change in $300.
I'm happy here, too.
Anyone else want to discuss that? Mr. Bean?
No, sir.
Mr. Nichols? So do we have a consensus that we want to go forward with this warrant article? It appears we have a consensus. Okay. Somebody else want to pick one out?
Everything you want to jump
Dick?
On, Ben, first?
Yeah, I've got a few, and I'm going to stay away from the DPW one still.
Okay.
There was $100,000 in the CIP replacing Kids Kingdom in 2013 that's not on the list. Is that an oversight, or is that being deferred? Or?
At this point, it's being deferred. I've asked the Recreation Department whether or not they wish to proceed with that and bring it to the board for discussion and approval. I don't have an answer to that as of yet.
I'll just give the board some feedback, and I've already given this to Fred several weeks ago.
Right.
I talked to Diana, and the main issue, it looks very good structurally and all that, but I guess the main issue is splinters, and there's a lot of flat boards that appear to me to be cedar that's, whatever, 2 inches or so. And if you look, I mean, it's 15, 16 years old on the top because of the weather, sun, water pooling on it, whatever. Kids can get splintered. But I stuck my head underneath, and all these boards look absolutely great on the bottom, and they're all held in by stainless steel screws, so it's not like it's a problem getting them out. My thought is maybe, as opposed to replacing it, you might be able to spend a small number of thousands of dollars, I don't know what, and literally, you know, flip the boards and with an orbital sander and whatever. But the rest of it, the plastic and the metal and everything else looks good, so I was kind of hoping that, you know, type of solution was going to be pursued as opposed to, you know, spending $100,000 now.
Well, I did talk with her, and she didn't quite agree with that.
Well, I think that's fine. But I think my suggestion would be somebody look at it. That mm-hmm. I suggested the carpenter and DPW, you know, take a look at that or whatever. But I think you really got to pull a few boards and flip them and, you know, make a judgment. But anyway, that's my input.
Anyone else want to discuss that particular warrant article?
Well,
it's not a warrant article. I'm happy in this postponement, and it's non-inclusion.
Mm-hmm. Right. I am, too. I think we ought to might look at what Richard suggested to see if somebody from DPW can really...
That's why it's being postponed. It's not mm-hmm. being put on there at the moment.
Put some spit and polish on. They might last another few years.
Okay. Did you want to continue?
Yeah, I got a few more. The Recreation Department space at Tuck Field... just a comment, and to be honest with you, I'm not negative, I'm not positive on it, but we would be using the majority of the parking lot income for office space as opposed to directly for recreation if we took that route. Some people may object to that. I'm not saying that I'm going to oppose it on that basis, but we've basically got somewhere in the vicinity of 75,000-ish per year that comes in, the 20% of parking lot revenues that's been typically used for things directly related to the fields. I know we used it to the hockey rink was some serious maintenance done to that. I think last year had to do with some of the fencing around Tuck Field whatever. So that's just more a comment. Question is, what is the operational objective of this warrant article? In other words, is it to be able to do work down at the Tuck Field recreation office space
in order to move the recreation department into that space?
They've run out of room here, and it's to the point where there are times during the year when you cannot even walk around their office because it's piled so heavily with material.
But would they be moving out completely and opening that space up for
yes.
other, so
yes.
it could be utilized by other departments or
yes,
whatever?
Yes, absolutely.
That, I think, would be a good thing. Is this $65,000, what does it represent in terms of, is this the just simply a design, or is this representing, you know, an estimate on everything that's got to be done in terms of designing it and doing whatever, maintenance or expansion or whatever?
They're doing the design this year. They have not gotten to it as of yet, and it was projected to do this into next year for construction. It's really a modification of the existing buildings, so we don't know yet.
But I guess my question is, I have a very, if we think it's $65,000 at the moment, and $65,000 becomes $75,000 or $80,000 leading up to, like, you know, the closeout of warrant articles, a deliberative
mm-hmm.
session or something
right.
like that, where there's an opportunity to change it, I think my tendency would be to support it. If, on the other hand, it was just a design and it was going to cost $300,000 to do the work, I'd have a very, if you follow where I'm coming from, Fred, I'd have a very different, you know, viewpoint on it.
I wouldn't be supporting it either for $300,000. The plan here was to, we appropriated some funds this year to take care of the two sheds that are collapsing at the Tuck Field. Those are being replaced. We're working on doing that now. And then the redesign of the footprint inside the buildings, so that, in fact, we could fit the recreation offices in there. That may call for a small addition to one of the buildings, but it's not going to be very much. We did agree internally that $65,000 was the upper limit of that.
So if we make this into an office, we're going to have bathroom facilities, electricity, heat, and plumbing, and all that.
They're already there.
Yeah, that's, and look, Mary, you've got $86,000 right now in the parking set aside for 2012.
Mm-hmm.
So you've got a little bit of room on the 65 should you need to use it. Which building is this going to be added to? Is it going to be added to the one that's, there's two buildings down there. One is not heated. That's my concern. One is just used
not
for...
It's the one that is heated.
Okay, and that's where she runs, that's where the department runs their summer programs out of.
That's correct.
It's air conditioned, it's heated, it's got the plumbing. They wouldn't be able to use that and still have the recreational program there during the summer without, you know, making an addition to that space.
It may have to be a small addition to the space.
Yeah, but we don't have any idea right now because the plan hasn't been developed. We don't have any idea how many square feet.
No, we don't.
Because 65,000, even if you go up to 80,000, you know, you're not talking about heavy hitting on plumbing, so that helps.
Right.
But you're not going to get much more than 600 square feet. That's being somewhat optimistic. How many square feet does she occupy in this space now?
She's got about 500 square feet there.
Yeah, I was going to say it's about that.
Okay.
I would prefer to have, at least by the time we roll around into late December, early January, either have a fairly solid number or not go forward with this.
The plan was to give you a proposal by that on paper. Otherwise, this can't go forward because we just don't have the...
So I'd like to consider this one kind of a work in process through,
right.
you know, whatever, November or December
exactly.
Until a firm number shows up.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Did we
want to shift to Keith rather than making him sit
It doesn't there? Matter either way. Keith, are you ready? Yeah. You want to join us at the table?
Good evening.
We're going to be discussing the 2013 DPW budget. Mr. Noyce has joined us. you want to open up?
On the budget, I'm here to respond to any of your questions. I have heard of...
Who wants to start?
I'll start.
Okay.
I'm led to believe that some of the answers that we had last week regarding the planning for the INI and the second one, I can't remember off the top of my head.
Facility plan.
Had actually been included in your budget, your operating budget. And I understand that there might have been a change in that this week, that some of those items have been moved from the operating budget into warrant articles.
Mm-hmm.
And that the intent of the line item description in the original budget, you'll still retain the monies
correct.
There so that they could be used for maintenance of either drains or sewers.
Correct.
So the operating budget has not been impacted in any other way other than to now redirect the monies that were in those two accounts back to the proper description or to the activity described by the description, and the items that were that you had said were covered by those two line items have that now both been moved to warrant articles.
Correct.
So
that's go ahead.
I was confused, and that's kind of where we left off last time. We've been just brought up, but if I understand it, then we were taking projects that had been in the operating budget through its original submission to the tune of $190,000, $100 for the INI study and $90 for the wastewater treatment plant facilities plan, removing those projects and substituting the INI and the facilities plan study for them, so there would have been things that didn't get done, and now we've shifted back almost to the original proposal where those projects are in the operating, and obviously I saw it in Fred's Warren article list, the 100 and the 90 respectively for the INI and the facilities plan will go forward as separate Warren articles.
Mm-hmm.
What was the reason for the shift back and the shift back and forth?
Well, I was just trying to cut down on the number of Warren articles as well, and for those two important projects, the facilities plan and the II, I thought I was doing the right thing by actually putting it into the operating budget.
Yeah. I'm fine with that. I would just point out that if the Warren article is rejected, they don't get done. That's all.
Correct.
But whatever.
And I just want to confirm, I asked Mr. Manager.
Sir.
I asked the manager earlier, last week, where the monies were for the, to cover the LOD on the Gristmill Dam, because the state wants a reply to that by October or November of 2013. And I just want to confirm with you that in account 4311.2.310, page 100, under engineering, there's a $40,000 budget, which is up significantly over the current year budget, and that is where the dam work is.
Correct.
It's a $40,000 budget. That's where the dam work will be done. Very well.
That's
I have no more questions on his operating budget.
Okay, Mr. Pierce.
Just to follow up on what Ben was saying, that is strictly for the dam, not the gristmill.
Correct.
Okay. And what does this include with this $40,000 again?
This would include initially a study of the dam, the LOD, and the dam itself to look at a number of options, and then it would get into either a preliminary design or a conceptual design.
So when we're looking at the state, and we have choices with the state with was it DES, EPA, whatever, they said we have choices of either fixing a dam or letting the water flow through it.
Mm-hmm.
And that seems to be the prevailing attitude in this country that old dams should be let the water flow through. So is that going to be included in this engineering design as a possibility?
In the initial study, that'll be one of the things they'll look at.
Okay.
Is the pros and cons of doing that.
Because we need to know that because it's maybe not Mike Pierce. I mean, it's right to me if it flows through, if it's dammed up. As far as where I live and where the dam is, but from a environmental pollution environment that we're all trying to lean towards, if all these people think flowing through is a good idea, I think we ought to make sure that that is well covered as one of our options in that $40,000. So that might be what we should do, is all I'm saying. Okay. And I have some other questions, but not in the budget particularly, so...
Mike, on the subject that we're on before we move off, just make a comment. So essentially, that $40,000, is it perceived that the dam or no dam study for the grist mill will eat up most of that $40,000, Keith?
We normally would have it ranged anywhere from $10,000 to $15,000 for general engineering, but Chris and I are doing a lot of the engineering ourselves now, so we've been saving a lot of money by
right. But do you think that the dam study is going to eat up most of that $40,000, or is there kind of is it perceived? I'll make up a number that's going to be 25 or 30, and there's money in there for miscellaneous other stuff.
Conservation Commission just put out the Ice Pond Dam, and it's not as complicated
right.
as this one, but I believe that they're looking at around $20,000 to $25,000 just for their preliminary design. So I kind of use that as a baseline.
So it's multiple with the grist mill study being a subset of the total $40,000, and a portion of, as opposed to the whole $40,000.
Right.
Okay. And the other question I have, just to kind of actually confirmation of understanding, is in the scope of the study, both replacing the dam or eliminating the dam will be considered options, and that we would have some sort of a report with it, which would indicate if one, the other, or both were in fact viable options, and maybe some estimate of the cost of one versus the other?
Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Can I ask a little bit more follow-up on that same point? You mentioned the ice pond. The Conservation Committee is going ahead with a study up there to see what to do with that.
That's my understanding.
They're spending their own money. They need how money for that? Or money from us, I mean.
Yeah, I don't know where they're getting the money, but it's not coming from Public Works budget.
Okay. And what are they planning up there off the top of your head, just real briefly?
They're just planning on doing the bare, it's my understanding, the bare minimum to repair the dam that's up there. The only involvement that I've had with that project is they asked me if I would help to call through the engineering proposals to select an engineer.
That sounds good. And I knew that they were wanting to replace that dam up there for a long time. I don't know if you guys have been up there. I took a tour up there a while back, walking through all the bushes all the way from, all the way around there. Anyway, to make a long story short, and the dam itself definitely needs to be modified or redone or something, so I don't have a problem with that, because but it looks like the rest of it's probably somewhat intact. Now, if we fix the dam at the ice pond, does that mean that sooner or later we're going to have to clean out the pond from the dredge it or whatever? Is that something
on the
horizon?
The ice pond? No, I don't think it's a function of what we have to do with the dam itself.
Right.
But it's kind of early on. I haven't been involved since the initial selection, so I don't know where they're at with that.
Now, if we repair the dam at the grist mill, and let's say that's one of the options we go for, that'll have to be dredged then, probably the pond will be, right? Sooner or later. Because it's really filled up.
If the answer is to open up the dam,
right.
To no longer have a dam, then of course the silt's going to be a factor.
Yeah.
If we just replace the dam, there'll be some removal of silt in the work area. There won't necessarily be required to remove all the silt. There's no question in my mind that if we get into dredging that pond, you're talking millions of dollars.
I agree.
$5-10 million to do that.
The reason why I bring that is because when I first moved here, which was a long time ago, when you drove along on No Shore Road, there was a nice little house right on the water there at the time. It was water. Now it's just weeds when they look out their back door towards the pond, because the pond's all filled in. And it's definitely filled up significantly, because that was water back when I first moved here. So that means it's filled in a lot just since I've been here. Of course, that's a long time, but in relation to the grist mill being there for 300 or 400 years, it's not that big a chunk. But you answered my question. Thank you, Keith.
May I ask one question?
Yes, please.
To the manager. I'm okay with Keith. We're not operating under an LOD as far as the ice dam or the ice pond dam.
It's a non-regulated structure.
Very well.
Mr. Bean, any questions about the operating budget?
Thank you for coming in on the holiday, Director.
I apologize.
We appreciate that. We understand Exeter has a different time zone. thank you. I have no questions, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions about the operating budget?
I have one.
Please.
Not really a question, more of a comment. I think that the trash and recycling pickup operation needs a thorough evaluation by management. We pick up about 6,500 properties at least once a week. Some locations are picked up 3 days a week. Stores and eating places are picked up 5 days a week year-round, 7 days a week in the summer. Between trash and recycling, which makes it times two, we've got about 14,000 or so stops a week. When you factor in the 2013 operating budget and the CI's peace plan to purchase three more loaders, one is proposed for 2013 and two in 2017. The decision to bring recycling pickup in-house will have cost us $120,000 more when compared to outside bids, which Fred got back in late 2010 as a benchmark. The original plan for bringing recycling in-house was sold based on labor savings from using mostly sidearms. A small number of routes were understood to require a rear loader. We staff rear loaders with three people versus one person on the sidearm. Based on the CIP, we now plan to purchase and own more rear loaders than sidearms, so presumably something in the ballpark of 50% of our stops would be picked up by vehicles with three people in them as opposed to one. I can get into more detail on my concerns, but the simple version is that while I have no intention of proposing that we make any changes to the operating budget at this point, I think we've got to go forward with what's currently going on through next year. I can't see myself approving the purchase of additional rear loaders with, again, every time we have a new one of those, we're kind of committed for 10 years to vehicles with three people on them. Waste management was picking up the recycling portion anyway, by and large, did the entire recycling route with one person. I believe they would, at times during the summer, have a second person on the truck, but our approach is three. So I'm simply saying that the action that is necessary, I think there needs to be a thorough evaluation of the whole logistics of the trash and recycling pickup. So.
I think that could be our first goal for 2013.
Yep, but what I'm kind of making my support for any purchase of rear loaders contingent on understanding that. So that's all I have in operating.
I'd like to follow up on that. I've been thinking about that a little bit when I was seeing these in the CIP. Not that we're on the CIP, but it reflects on this. In order, like Richard said, we sold the recycling. It was going to be basically a little more economical, slightly, to do it in-house, or at least no cost, and we thought we could do a better job. No argument with any of that. I am concerned about the automatic picker-upper, sidearm, doodads, whatever you call those fancy trucks that cost us an arm and a leg. Why aren't we using more of those?
Just logistically, they don't work well in certain areas of town. We use those type of trucks are good more for like the Midwest or down in Florida where you got 90-degree roads and so forth. In certain areas of our town, we are using them. But down at the beach and some of the smaller roads, it's just not practical to use them. The other thing is we're finding they're very mechanically, they need a lot of work and maintenance because they're so mechanical. We've had quite a few breakdowns with them. So it's a combination of factors. It's not any one factor. I can tell you that we use them as much as we possibly can. There's no reason we wouldn't. The guys like them better. You know, they're not as you know manual labor as the others, manually intensive. But this town is a tough town geographically to use those type of trucks. And it's not just the summertime, it's, you know, in the wintertime as well, but more so in the summertime when, you know, we've got to pick up the huge volume of trash and recycling at the beach area.
Well, the reason why I'm asking that question is because I have not got one complaint about people not getting their trash picked up or their recycling picked up, which is unusual. I haven't had any of those calls in quite some time. But I've got people calling and playing and saying, why aren't we using the sidearms on the street, like Winnicott, Little River Road, and Mill Road, and the list just goes on of all these nice, big, open streets.
We use them in every place that's practical, with the system that we're using, you know, the way they're picking up. We've been doing it just over a year now, just over a year.
Uh-huh.
And the guys are getting better at it, and they're, you know, tweaking the system, and I think it's becoming more efficient. But it's a huge change from what they're used to.
Oh, I'm not debating that part with you at all. I figured when we moved over there, we'd have some serious challenges, and I'm not criticizing that part at all, because anytime you change things, it's always difficult at best for everybody. But I'm just concerned from what I got for complaints, which usually taxpayers are complaining about the lack of service rather than the kind of service, which is the argument here. They want to know, why can't we use the sidearms on Little River Road?
It might be part of a bigger route. It may be just, you know, we're not going to take the sidearms and just bebop around town. You know, it makes sense to have consecutive routes. So there may be, you know, three or four roads in one particular route that you can't use the sidearms. So that may force us to use the rear loader. Just so you know, I did, you know, I've been concerned about this, and about last fall, I guess it was, I hired someone from the outside, a logistics coordinator, to come in to work with my guys to see if there's any, you know, ways to make streamline the routes and so forth.
Right.
And, they came up with somewhat of a plan, but then it didn't work out as well as we had hoped. It was just a small investment. It was just a cursory review.
Mm-hmm.
But I have wanted to take another look at it, possibly with this person to come in fresh eyes to look at the again.
But just so you'll know, another one right along that same line, and I don't want to drag this on. I really don't. But I got another complaint from one of the people who lives at the beach. You know, at the wintertime, they get the street, get the trash and recycling picked up three times a week. They only need it once a week at the best. So I think we need to, like you said, we really need to look at these routes more closely, define which ones are capable of being picked up by the sidearms, which ones need to be picked up every week, which ones need to be three times a week, and which ones are, was it seven times a week at the beach in the wintertime? Chairman, I think it is seven times a week for some of the business.
Seven times a week at the beach,
for
only
business.
In the summer,
yeah.
And I believe only, based on the documentation I got from Keith, only selective types of businesses, for example, stores and restaurants, I believe they drop back to 5 days a week. And by the way, it's not just the beach that gets this seven-day and five-day selectively, depending on the season. I think the same type of thing takes place, like on Lafayette Road as well.
Road.
So, I mean, I guess what I'm saying at the bottom, at the end of the line here on this, what I'm trying to drive to is, I think we need to have a list of how many pickups we do with this route, how many of that route, where they are, what kind of a vehicle can do it, how many people it needs for all those, so you can really get it down to a down to a science as to how you can address that. Because if we keep going with our recycling the way we're going right now, the taxpayers will say, what the hell are we doing this for? Why don't we just get rid of all of it, farm it all out? And right now, I can almost see that argument, because I'm a tightwad, and that's music to my ears if we can do it cheaper outside.
The argument is there today in the numbers.
Right. So I think if we want to keep it in-house, if we do, which I'm all for all by itself, but I'm not all for keeping it in-house if it's going to cost everybody a lot more money to do it that way. So I think what we need to do is streamline what we're doing, like you mentioned earlier, know exactly how many people we pick up here, there, and so on, how we can pick them up, because I know there's some streets, like Cole Street, the beach, you're going to have to take a small back-end loader down that street. And that raises another question. Why do we buy a bigger back-end loader if all these streets are such a tight concern?
We got a very good deal on that, and it's working out very well. That particular truck is a 20-yarder.
Yeah.
They fit it right into the process, so that's actually very efficient. it's a balance there. It's a balance. We're trying to continue with the level of service that the town has used to been using, but taking on a huge undertaking, which is the recycling.
Right.
With the resources that we have.
Right.
Now, on Cole Street, do you pick up there once a week or three times a week?
I couldn't tell you off the top of my head.
Three times a week.
Yeah.
No, I mean in this winter.
Winter's
probably once.
I believe just once.
Yeah, because, you know, I know that for years they've picked up the trash like where I'm at three times a week. I have brought it up long before you were here to the other people that were here before. There's no need to do the three times a week during the summer.
I will testify.
And I've mentioned it over and over and over again, but for some reason it's felt on deaf ears here always.
I will testify to the fact that this is at least the third time Rick has brought it up since I've been on the board.
It makes no sense.
This is why I'm suggesting that this needs to be looked at. It's not just that reason. I believe the possibility exists that there may be a third option beyond the current sidearm and the current rear-end loaders. And before we go out and buy one or two or three more rear loaders, we ought to properly investigate those options. I also believe...
Rick, I can assure you that we've been having those discussions in-house. I'm looking at right now, you know, what we're going to do with the trash, but both trash and recycling for the year 2015. We're locked into waste management to at least July 1st of 2015.
Where we take the stuff.
Right. In fact, the way we designed our recycling contract with Triano, the hauler, is just through July 1st of 2015, even though we could have gone for a five-year contract, so that everything kind of expires at one time. So then I can. So in the meantime, I'm going to take a look at the bigger picture. I mean, I'm in process right now, and I'll probably be coming to the board soon about talking about some options of taking our recycling to EcoMaine as we would get actually a better deal. So I am looking at those areas, but I'm looking more at the bigger picture at this point, figure out, you know, what we're going to do at that time, because in the meantime, right now, we're kind of locked into where we're at. That doesn't mean we can't tweak the routes. We'd like to do that, anything that we can do, because what I'd like to do is be able to use that manpower on, you know, street work and sidewalks and so forth.
Well, the summertime is one thing, but the wintertime is another. They don't need to have pickup anywhere along Ocean Boulevard three times a week. I mean, I don't even understand it, really. And especially with the barrels that are the size they are now, they definitely hold everything from, you know, for a week, I would think, for most people.
I would like to, I have two suggestions as to the way, and I accept what you just said, the way we go from here. One is at some point, certainly prior to the January cutoff date on warrant articles or whatever, I'd like to have something come back to us that addresses some of the points that have been raised here, from Rick's point of why do we pick up three times a week in the winter to my concern over purchasing more rear loaders or whatever. And that's fine as far as operating or whatever, but I'd like to make that request. And just so you know, when we get to the DPW CIP, I'm going to propose there are three vehicles in there, $315,000. I'm going to be proposing that the rear loader be removed from that list of vehicles, and that we simply go forward with the other two, the two trucks. I think there's a one-ton and a six-wheel dump truck.
Are we ready to move
on? No, we can talk. We'll go to there in a minute.
And may I just, Mr. Chairman, along this line of discussion, which is perfectly appropriate, is there a need for the director, with his responsibilities and his powers, to get our approval to change route frequency?
No.
Pickup, and why can't he do that immediately, post it on the website, inform people, and start achieving
And, you know, maybe if you're going to post something new on the website, you could post, this isn't anybody's fault, but I noticed today, they didn't pick up the trash, right, and the recycling.
It's a holiday.
It's a holiday. Everybody on Ocean Boulevard had their barrels out. So, you know, in fact, when I walked out this morning, the first one I got to had a TV box in there, and they had it hanging over, and they still have the styrofoam in it. So I, you know, people just don't understand that we don't take styrofoam, so I grabbed it out of that, folded the box up, So some people just don't listen, but almost everybody had their trash out.
Not just Ocean Boulevard.
All over town. So.
Well, it does get confusing.
I know, and that's
through Labor Day.
We got a flash.
I'm not putting words in Keith's mouth, but Public Works picks up on a Monday holiday through the summer months.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden Labor Day happens, and they revert to observing holidays.
We have to think of some way to get it out there.
Rick, I think just I don't want to
like dogs on the beach.
And I'll do this in about 30 seconds. But Paul Paquette is actively working on a kind of a very different infrastructure to the website, different content management system, and the whole bit. And if you look at some of the other municipalities, and I think Keene is a great example, and I happen to be on the Keene list, I'll get 4 or 5 emails a week, you know, from Keene of this type of thing. Don't forget, you know, we're not picking up trash tomorrow, or we're shutting down the so-and-so bridge for some sort of maintenance or whatever, and it's absolutely great. So I think there is a solution, and it's not forever down the road.
Maybe that's something the committee there can take up.
Oh, no, exactly.
Okay, so let's move on to the 2013 DPW CIP. Did you want to open that up, or?
I'm just really prepared to respond to
Dick,
questions.
Did you want to go with it since you suggested?
That's my only comment, and is just on the first one, anyway. Is simply that at this point I would support the other two pieces of equipment that are in there. And again, I think the three, there are currently three pieces of equipment in that. I think the way the Warren article was written is consistent with what you were suggesting, correct, Ben?
Yes, it is. The way it's been worded in our most recent draft, October the 4th.
Yep. However, I'm fine with the first two items at 80 and 110,000, but I think we need to hold off on rear load packers until we, get a better understanding of what's going on.
Dick, if I may on that, because that's important. Frank and I have been talking in house about deferring the purchase of a new truck. It's not an additional truck, a replacement. Once we see how much work it's going to take to repair the one that we have right now.
Truck meaning the Packer.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Okay.
Exactly. So I'd ask that we don't pull it out of the budget. I have no problem with
you mean out of the warrant article.
Out of the warrant article, because in the end, we're going to have the same number of trucks as we have now. We have to have 7 trucks. We have to have a backup truck in order for repairs and also to use as a backup when we're servicing one of the other 6 trucks.
Let's basically consider this a work in process between now and beginning of January. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
It does. I'd like to voice concerns with when you mentioned that, you know, I have the authority to switch routes and days. There's no doubt that that's a political issue. To be truthful with you, if I had my way, I'd tell people once a week, period. And that way we could get a lot more done on the roads and elsewhere. But I understand that that's easier said than done, if we were to say that.
The concern that I have at a high level, maybe if I articulate it a little bit different, is when I look at the CIP, we've already purchased one rear loader. Another one is in there for 13, two for 2017. Those are essentially just replacements of ones that we have now. We've then got 4 rear loaders and 3 sidearms, which says to me somewhere roughly 50% of these, 6,500 locations that some are once a week, some are multiple times a week or whatever, we're picking up with a rear loader. I can fully understand that places like Cole Street, I can fully understand that maybe the letter streets, particularly in the summer, are not conducive to the sidearm because of the parking getting in the way or whatever. But I can't for the life of me imagine that the sidearms can only work for 50% of the 6,500 locations in town. And that's why what I really want to see that's going to get me comfortable is something that's on a piece of paper. It's a spreadsheet. It outlines all the routes. And on those routes, it identifies the type of pickup. Is it a sidearm? Is it a rear loader? Do we put some time into looking if there's a third alternative? Because obviously waste management had a different way of doing it from the standpoint of a truck. what frequency are we picking up at those locations? And my experience in things that aren't trash, but they're every bit as operationally complicated, is when you start digging into things on an analytical level like that, you find opportunities and you ultimately do things better and save money. That's basically what I'm requesting. But I think we can consider it. We're not here to say yes or no tonight.
I know, but I need some clarity on what you want me to do. If you want to look at just, can we make the existing routes more efficient, that's easy to do, relatively easy to do. I mean, we've already done that. Maybe we weren't as successful as we had hoped, but my intentions was good to look at that to make the routes more efficient. But now if you're talking about, Rick's talking about is cutting down.
I agree that what Rick is talking about is different, okay, than doing the exact same thing in different ways, okay, in terms of, he's talking about frequency of pickup. But I think that we need to look at both, and I don't think we're going to resolve it tonight, but if you and Fred want to get together with me, I'd be happy to give you, you know, some of my experience in similar type of logistical operations. You know, I think we could easily spend an hour here before you understood where I was coming from.
And I'm talking about just in the winter time, if there's more than one time. I mean, I don't see why it should be any different than it is uptown. It's once a week, right? Or
no, some of them are.
I mean, but in regular neighborhoods,
right?
Residential neighborhoods.
Residential neighborhoods. Okay. Yeah.
Irrespective of the season.
That's pretty much what's happening at the beach too. I mean, I think that. As far as I know, most of the commercial establishments are taking their stuff to the beach, to the transfer station, places like the Ashworth that are busy in the summertime.
I went for a ride with my rubbish foreman to every stop on Lafayette Road to get a sense, just like when I rode on the back of the Packer down at the beach, to get a better sense of what we're up against. So then I went with him to visit all these locations that we're picking up up to three times a week. And we started a dialogue with the businesses, asking them how they would feel about dropping it down, lessening, and most of the businesses were not in favor of that, you know. And some of the businesses, we have to go in to the back of their building to pick up. It's very inefficient.
Mm-hmm.
I just get a real sense.
No, I would suggest, you know, it makes sense to me that they should just be putting it out on the road, and that's how we're supposed to be picking up the trash.
Without dressing that.
Other than that, they would be having private.
It's got to be on the public right away. But anyway, yeah. I don't want to. This will be longer than an hour.
And it's probably part of the bigger conversation.
I understand where you're coming from. We have Keith. It's the middle of October. One of the things that I know is on his priority list is getting the bid documents ready to go out on Church Street. I'm not sure how close that process is. Is it close?
We're going to have a bid opening the Thursday before Christmas.
Yes, which means there's a lot of stuff that has to happen between now and the Thursday before Christmas.
Yes, very much.
I would ask your consideration of making this something that we do discuss in 2013. If there are two Packers that follow this one in 2014 and 2015, we still have an opportunity to save the taxpayers money by not purchasing one of the ones scheduled for those later years. Let's let this one go forward to the voters, but use 2013 as a year to really seriously look at the ins and outs, either from the department and giving us recommendations, or if we choose to go through the spreadsheets, give me adequate notice so I can schedule vacation time. But seriously, that was facetious. I'm interested in saving the money. I think that we got enough priorities for him right now without throwing another one on.
I think there's a compromise. I think I'm fine with what you said about deferring it to 2013, but what I'd like to see is still defer the Packer and find a way to make the mix of older Packers that we've got work.
I'm happy to remove the Packer from the warrant article, but I don't want it to be something that we're still discussing in January. December.
That's fine. And if there's a crisis,
but that might not be fine for him, but it's okay by me.
If there's a crisis and it's determined that Packer cannot be made to work for 2013, then come back to us.
For 2013?
Right.
So are we going to keep the Packer in there, but just hold not? Can we just keep it in there and give us a chance in 2013 to look at it more? And I'll tell you right now, we won't be purchasing a Packer until we look at this. But I just hate to go a whole year without having something that we may need. I can't say right now. We're evaluating that right now. We still, the important thing is for you to know, we have the need for 7 trucks. The one that we're replacing is in bad condition. So there's a concern. If our one and only spare is not usable, then we're down to 6 trucks, which we need in the middle of the summer, and we don't have a spare. So this is important. So what we would do typically, and I'm agreeing with you in the sense of not going out after the vote, assuming it was positive, and purchasing a Packer. We've already talked internally about looking at all this next year. But I do have an awful lot on my plate right now, and I really don't.
No, and I'm sympathetic to that.
Yeah.
I think Ben's point is good in that. I think that there's potentially, I just go back to waste management somehow doing it with one person. Everywhere, okay? And we've got rear-end Packers with 3. There may be another solution besides the 2 that we're seeing in front of us today, and I'd like that being looked at before we're sitting on a second $125,000 rear-load Packer.
Let me throw another compromise. Let's write the article, the warrant article that the manager has prepared that covers the $315,000. Let's rewrite it at $190,000. And have another written that just covers the Packer.
Okay.
And that'll be the one that we hold on to.
Okay.
And we'll see what the mood of the room is.
Yep.
Before the budget
sounds good.
Submission date.
I agree with Ben.
Good.
I have one other point I'd like to make before we move off of this. The problem I'm having with this the big picture is, why are we buying more rear end loaders when we should be buying more sidearms? That's the problem I'm having. Not saying that's the way it should be, saying that's the problem I'm having. Therefore, I don't want to buy any rear Packers at all unless we absolutely have to, because if you've already got 4 out of 7, we should be striving to get 6 out of 7 for sidearms.
Because the rear load Packer is the intention is for it to be a spare. And the beauty about that is it can be used in both locations. If we got another sidearm, mm-hmm. we're restricted as far as where we would use that as a spare.
Well, you could bump one of the rear end loaders to the spare, in theory, because you're going to use more sidearms.
There are some places you can't use.
We're not going to solve the problem that we're pushing off for 2013.
Any other comments, Mr. Bean?
I have no comments, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, so do we want to move on?
We left it with Ben's approach, right?
Yes.
Okay, you want to go down anything else on the CIP, or are you finished with the CIP?
Oh, we're waiting for you to bring something
up. Oh, okay. Yeah, I'm looking at the CIP in general, and it isn't that I'm against doing any of these particular issues. It's just that we're going to really load down the taxpayers here. We're looking at significant increases in the tax rate in the next
Which one are you talking about, sir?
I'm talking about CIP that was dated.
Yes, sir. Which article?
Which article?
We're going to talk about them one at a time.
CIP.
Yep. Oh, CIPs are, well, okay.
Which one are you doing?
I'm
Warren Ackles or CIP?
No, CIP.
That's what I'm doing.
Go ahead.
Are you okay, Ben?
Yeah.
Okay. No problem. I'm looking at the one that was dated, the last one we got that was dated 10-4 this year. The second page has all the projects on the left. If we keep adding all this stuff onto the taxpayers, we're going to get really chopped on the tax increases. We're going to be doing 7%, 8%, 9% increases, and that's really going to, if we go at that rate, none of us will be able to afford to live here. I don't even care how wealthy you are, Ben or Phil. But anyway, I'm looking at the sewer and drain building vehicle equipment wash bay for $500,000. That sounds like a dream to me. Can you like to elaborate on that a little bit?
It is a dream. It's a dream for us.
Good, and we can mark it off the list if it's just a dream.
No, it's a hope because we need the building. That's multifunction, and right now, most of our sewer and drain equipment is left outside. we don't have enough room to keep it inside. And also, the workspace that my mechanics have is being shared between the wastewater treatment plant and the sewer and drain people. So it's really confined quarters. We don't have good enough places to work in the winter when it's inclement weather. We need place for our inventory. We need a wash bay. That's something that isn't federally mandated, but it's certainly federally encouraged because of the way you have to have to treat the wastewater, the drain, the wash water that comes off washing the vehicles. You can't just go outside and just do it any place now with the new stormwater regulations.
Mm-hmm.
So we look at this as making our operation more efficient, actually. And help. And this is what we talked about a number of months ago, or a month or so ago, about, you know, if we're able to wash the vehicles throughout, that's going to extend the life. And we're not talking about just public works vehicles, but police, fire, all the other town vehicles, by having this wash bay and keeping things inside. So
more comments on that?
Sure. I mean, I'm all set. I mean, I have no problem accepting washing the vehicles up. And according to this comment here, it's about $100,000 on your comment. And I remember some number run by us before, 140 or something like that before. I remember hearing that. But $100K for the wash bay, I don't have a big problem with. I just can't see $400,000 to store trucks in and do maintenance on, because we have a big maintenance shop down there now. It's probably bigger than anything else in Hampton for maintaining vehicles. And it's just that the part that I just have a huge problem with. Nearly $500,000 to store trucks in when we don't know that if they're clean and they're stored outside that they'll last just as long inside as they will outside.
So that, let me finish.
That has not been proven to me. And if you need more maintenance room down at your facility there, you've already got a 3 or 4 bay garage now.
Correct.
Yeah.
Right.
If the
plan, what I'm trying to say is that it's more than just storing equipment. It's for office space for that crew to be able to work out of. It's for inventory. It's for the vehicles, it's for the maintenance. We've been looking at making the second floor having a training room. We don't have a training room at Public Works right now. I certainly wouldn't suggest that we should build a building just for a training room, mm-hmm. but we're trying to get the biggest bang out of the buck with this design. So we're having on the proposed design includes a training room so that we can have training sessions. As it is right now, we have to either come up here or go down the police department, which again in itself is not difficult, but we're trying to incorporate as many uses of this building as possible. So I just want you to know it's more than just storing. It's not like just having a garage next to your house where you're just putting your vehicle in there and doing an oil change occasionally. There is a real need for this building for our troops to be able to work out of efficiently. And this is not a new issue. I look back in the CIP, it's been asked for a number of years by prior directors to have this facility.
Well, one other comment, and then I'll let everybody else take a shot. We have one of the most excellent training facilities probably in New Hampshire when it was built, because it cost nearly $1 million at the police station. And for me, as a taxpayer, it's wonderful that you're using that and getting a lot of use out of that facility, because for some time it was not utilized as much as I would have liked to have seen it. So I have no problem using a nice facility where I already have for training at the police station. I have no problem with that part. So that takes away a little chunk of your expenditure on the $400,000. So if we wipe that part away, what do we got left? You want an office for the guys that work on the streets and drains? Well, it seems like to me most of the time when I see those guys are out in the vehicles out working on streets and drains, so I can't understand why they need a big office area, number one. And number two, if we're looking at only storing the vehicles, I know a lot of us in Hampton store our own personal cars out in the driveway because my garage is full of PCs and other sort of junk. And my little car I drove tonight is 20 years old, and it's not rusting apart. So I don't know if I buy keeping it inside. I can buy the washdown, but I can't buy the maintenance building.
Okay, let someone else comment. Mr. Moore.
Thank you. You gave us plans, I believe, or preliminary plans. I think that was distributed to all the board. 7 bays, 1 bay for offices on the first floor with a conference room or a meeting room above, 5 regular bays just for storage, you know, for with overhead doors that were for equipment storage, and then 1 bay for washdown. This is a metal building. I don't believe there's too much additional expense in throwing, if you went from 6 bay or from 7 bays down to 6, one of which was an office, one of which was a wash bay, and took out one of the regular middle bays that you have, you're not changing the value, the construction cost that much. I think that we probably want to consider looking at this as something that we build for the future. There's a lot of miscellaneous small equipment down there. I don't think if there was a question of having a significant amount of savings, and if you tell me that there is, then I want to explore it in going from 7 bays, 140 feet, down to 120 feet. There's a significant savings in the construction cost. Let's talk about it, but I don't think there is. Just and we get a lot of the miscellaneous small equipment.
If I may just respond to that, we've got a couple of contractors right now that are pricing out the building. And I did ask them to look at the option of two options. One is, as the 7 bays has proposed, but also cutting it down to see what the savings would be. My sense with that type of building, it's not going to be a huge savings.
Not with a metal building. You'll save some on concrete.
Right.
I'm still happy with the concept. We're probably building it a little bit larger than you might need today, but I think that's what you should do when you're doing this, because you don't want to go through this every other year. You want to do this every 30 years, maybe. I'm still happy with the wash bay. Having some additional office space down there is not a bad thing. We haven't put much investment in your department as far as bricks and mortar for a while, other than stuff that processes the wastewater. So I'm still comfortable with the article as it's been presented.
Okay. Mr. Nichols.
Yeah, just some clarification to the numbers here. I'm looking at the verbiage in the picture, and it looks to me like it's 5 vehicle bays, regular vehicle bays, plus 1 wash bay, plus a bay for administrative space. Am I off there?
No,
I was saying 7. It's
right, but we talk bays as far
right,
as
so
cost
it,
out.
So
of it.
It's 5 plus 1 plus administrative
correct.
Space. Okay. In 2010, I agree with Keith that this idea has been around, in particular the wash bay, for as long as I've been either on the Budget Committee, the Board of Selectmen, whatever. But in 2010, it was submitted with, and to clarify the numbers Mike had, $200,000 for the building and $146,000 for the wash bay. What's changed from last year? Did it have more bays this year? Or I mean, obviously, that's like a 45% increase from what was proposed last year to this year.
I don't believe it was proposed last year.
Last year, I looked at it this afternoon. The 2010 CIP was submitted with a wash bay at $146,000 and a sewer and drain building at $200,000.
I don't know. I guess Doug Mellon put those numbers.
No, it was from you. It was done. No, it was submitted November 29th of 2011.
I thought you said 2010.
Well, they called the 2010 CIP, whatever, I don't know. I'll be happy to email you a copy of that.
No,
it was the last CIP.
When you
last
said
years.
From 2010, I thought you were referring to before when I got here.
Yeah, no, it was the last CIP, and to be fair
that
to you, you were only here for 4 or 5 months, I think, at the time.
And that was a cursory look at it at that point. We have refined it, as I've said, with all of the CIP items. As we get closer to them, we hone in on what the actual cost would be. In this situation, we've actually gone out and had a preliminary design done to give us more, a better idea of what the cost will be, rather than just guessing at it.
So it's basically the same conceptually with a different cost.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that it got bigger or anything like that. And another comment that I would make is I looked at the I'm not real high on spending. I think the wash bay makes sense. and I think you may need, how many bays do you have today for working on vehicles at Public Works? Isn't there like six or seven or so?
Well, the mechanics right in the main office area, there's about three or four bays in there.
And then there's another.
And then there's other storage bays.
Yeah, I just happened to glance at it as I was driving down 101. It looked like there was six or seven bays there, whatever.
But they're not set up with tools, and, you know, that's the other thing for this one crew is to have their own workspace where they can have their own tools and keep it organized and clean the way they want it. It'll be more efficient than trying to, you know, go into other areas to do the work, like into highway or, you know, into the truck bays. That's just mechanics working in there, you know, on the vehicles. This is not, we're not looking at having these truck bays to actually do work on the vehicles themselves. It's more like, for instance, the jet truck needs general maintenance that we wouldn't ask the mechanics to do. You know, the mechanics would, you know, change a battery and do something like that. So.
Okay. My comment is I'm very much in favor of what you said of looking a little bit deeper and seeing what kind of savings there might be, you know, if it were a scaled-down garage. Okay, I'm in favor of the wash bay and trying to clarify Ben's point as to whether or not there may be a minimal savings of going from three, you know, six bays to three bays or whatever. And I would just, I'm not, quite frankly, in favor of spending any serious money to just simply store stuff inside. I looked at the three vehicles you're asking for on the DPW plan, the three you want to replace, and they're like 12, 17, and 25 years old. And if you start, you know, having a wash bay, that's only going to make it better, you know, going forward. But let's see what you get from that. And those are my comments on the sewer and drain building and the wash
bay. Mr. Bean?
Are we speaking in general about the entire?
No, about the sewer and drain building.
Sewer drain building, long overdue. Public Works has a nasty, dirty, challenging, cold, humid, hot, disease-borne atmosphere that they work in every day. That building has been there since well before my time, and I worked there in 1972. It's a tough job. The men down there and the women down there do a great job. It's one of the few capital expenditures that I'm enthusiastic about going forward across all departments. So I do support it, and good luck on it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And I feel the same way.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now, did we want to go to the next?
Sure. You want me to
continue, Mr. Pierce?
I can, sure. A road and sidewalk improvements. We have the extra road in downtown intersection and so on and so forth for the extra road. Are you going to put that in a separate warrant article, do the whole extra road? Because I can remember it being rolled around that you thought it'd be somewhere in the ballpark of $2.4 million. So do you want to have a warrant article that'll spread that over a period of time as it progresses, or how did you want to approach it rather than throwing money here and throwing money at it here and there?
I was looking at it in a three-phase approach that in 2013 we'd have a warrant article for $300,000 to survey the road and to put together the design work to replace the sewer system, the storm drain system, and also to reconstruct the roadway. And then in 2014 we would have a warrant article to replace the sewer and the drains. And then in 2015, after I give it a year to settle, we would look at reconstructing the road. So it'd be a three-phased approach. The other important factor in this is that, you know, we're starting the process of coming up with a long-term maintenance plan, and it's all interwoven together. We're looking at the II study, which is a step in trying to get a handle on the priorities for the sewer system and the storm drain system. So they all mesh together. So I'm actually looking at Exeter Road. Again, I'm trying to get the biggest bang for the buck. So rather than just go out there and spend money and do resurface a road only to find out that you got to replace the sewer, you should have replaced the sewer, it doesn't make sense. So we're trying to do it proactively. So this here actually buys us a little time before we invest any money in other areas of town right now to until we get the results of the II study and the pavement management program.
Oh, then to sort of be more specific on my question, phase one will be basically a chunk of money to look at the planning, engineering, on Exeter Road.
And providing cost, good cost estimates to replace the storm drain, the sewer, and to reconstruct the roadway.
Okay. And phase two will be to do the sewer work.
And the storm drain.
15 will be the road. So you'll have three separate warrant articles, three consecutive years. That answers my question on that issue, on that particular line.
Mr. Moore, would you like to comment?
No question. No comments or questions on the $300,000 for road and sidewalk improvements.
Mr. Bean, did you want to comment?
Mr. Chairman, I would just reserve a moment at the end of this for some general comments, but I have no comments on this, please.
Mr. Nichols?
My only comment is to add up the numbers to do with Exeter Road. And we essentially already spent $600,000 this year for the Timber Swamp Road west portion of it, $2.1 million in 2014 to do the sewer and sewer work and the wastewater collection work, and then $550,000 for the pavement in 2015. So the total price tag on Exeter Road is is roughly about $3.5 million.
$3.5 million. Oh, you're including the western half of Exeter Road, okay.
Which was already done. Yeah, I'm saying that 600 is already done, and another 2.9 to go.
And I would just caution, those numbers that I have put in there for the sewer and the drain is just.
We'll get better after your $300,000.
Exactly. Yep. We just, in Public Works, we typically use as just an initial factor as $100 a foot to replace a pipe.
Yep, I understand.
Okay, did you want to continue, Mr. Pierce?
You want to go on to the next item?
Yeah.
Okie dokie. Wastewater collection system and study. That's an area way outside of my purview, so I'm going to pass the conversation over to my compadre, Mr. Ben Moore.
Well, thank you, sir. Just so I understand, the spreadsheet that we have dated whatever it was, October or something, has now been modified to $100,000. That was $350,000. Is that accurate?
That's correct.
Okay. And we're going to concentrate that study in the beach areas because we believe that might be the largest potential savings for switchovers.
Plus lowering the amount to try to, from the $350,000 to trying to, you know, still save a little money there for the time being.
Deferring, yeah.
Deferring.
As much as I think that we could throw the money right into the ground and replace a pipe, we know we don't have enough money to replace all the pipes. We better do a little bit of work as far as determining which pipe gets replaced first. So with that, rather than spend the money on actually digging a hole and putting down a new pipe, I would go with $100,000 study.
Okay.
I would support it.
Mr. Nichols.
Yeah, I would just add, Ben used the word defer in there, and just so everybody's clear, we didn't reduce the study from 350 to 100. We broke it down into two pieces,
yeah.
100,000 in 2013 and 250,000 in 2014. I have a couple of comments. One is, and this is nothing for the 2013 warrant, but I'd like to see some of the results of the 100,000 2013 and understand, you know, the benefits and all that before going forward on the next step of the 250. The other point I have is a question. We talked about a little bit last time. For studies of this sort, I see a benefit. I'm not sure what the trade-off saw, but I see a benefit of doing some of this stuff in-house based on the institutional knowledge that you gain as opposed to doing it with an outside consultant. If you have a person, the person works for you, and hopefully they hang around for, you know, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, or whatever, and they do it. When something else arises, you know, 3 years down the road or whatever, that knowledge is still there. If you do it with outside engineering firms, which is the way it's implicit to me in the fact that it's a warrant article with a number on it as opposed to a body and an operating statement that you that you lose that. So that's just kind of a question, and I'm not really bringing it up. My reason for bringing it up didn't pop into my mind because I'm saying, oh, you can do it less expensive in-house. It's more a function of the benefits down the road of that knowledge, fully understanding that you don't do stuff in-house like design Church Street pump stations or whatever.
I can assure you that with all our projects, we work hand-in-hand with the engineering firms, and my guys enjoy that. They've said that they've never had that kind of involvement before, and I encourage that. What, even with Church Street pump station, we're part of the design team. It'd be the same thing with this II study. It's not a matter of just having an engineering firm come in and just throwing them the project and say, come back with a report. We're intimately involved with all of these projects. Right now, we're in the process of surveying and mapping the sewer and drain system. And we've hired an engineer to come in to go around with their GPS locators because they have the very sophisticated and accurate technology to do it. But we have a guy that's going with him on an everyday basis to locate the manholes and to understand where they're at. So I'm with you on that, and I can tell you that there's not any project in Public Works right now that's just throwing it to an engineer and saying, doing it. But just not just for that reason, but part of that reason, what you're saying. The guys, I think it's good for the morale. They're part of it. They like seeing these projects being done and completed. They like being part of having the responsibility for it and the pride and goes for it. So there's all kinds of advantages in doing just what you're saying.
If this were approved in March, the $100,000 to focus on the beach, would this study be complete well in advance of a dialogue about whether or not to spend $250,000 in 2014 on the balance of it?
Yeah, because I really would like to capture, have this in place for the summer.
Okay.
To get the volumes that we're talking about there. So
okay.
That would be my intention.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Comments, Mr. Bean?
Yeah, I'm just going to jump to my one-minute general on this, on your work. Great work, and I know you've just been here a year, and you and your people do excellent
Thank
work.
Thank you.
You've inherited a lot of challenges. But in the Warren Auto, the Public Works Capital Equipment, it talks about taking money from the undesignated general fund. The Wall Street Journal came out with the fourth California town that is going bankrupt probably this month. One of the reasons is the downward pressure on real estate values, which are really the town's assets, the source of our revenue. And there may or there may not be, but there probably are pressures that are attacking that revenue source from this town. So that undesignated fund balance is great to say it exists, but in reality, if this were a private corporation or this was an accounting and someone offering real notes with integrity, that may not be available to taxpayers. That may not be available for town meeting warrant articles. That, in essence, may be already vanished. And going forward, these towns, there's a common thread that runs through them, at least in California and some of these other municipalities, is they've overspent on infrastructure. And you can't sell back the infrastructure. You can't take back the pipes. And what has happened in this is that leadership has allowed people that are citizens and people in positions of leadership, they take a short position. And the short position is, as you read these stories and these tragedies, is that the employees get shorted and the taxpayers get shorted. And then the employees lose their health insurance. They lay them off. They cut their retirement benefits. And I'm very concerned, as I know the board is, about this. On this 4 October list, and this goes not just for you, but for all departments in the town of Hampton, there's 15 lines here. It's over $9 million of new money. Of those 15 lines, you've got 15 more that say TBD, to be determined. So the average run rate on this is $600,000 a unit. You do another $600,000 a unit on a TBD, you're talking another $9 million. There have been comments here that not only through the town side, but on the school side, these are just too aggressive. And I do support some of your things here, but collectively, I wanted to put that out on the table. And we've got other things in terms of pensions already promised to New Hampshire or to employees in this town. That's coming downrange. We've got pay raises. We've got other contingencies in addition to this undesignated fund balance that may be very well gone. So I want to take special care in that and to drill down. And the points that fellow board members make so astutely is that it must be absolutely necessary. And these studies really must yield great, great dividends that absolutely are force multipliers for saving tax dollars. Thank you.
Did you want to continue, Mr. Pierce?
You want me to jump in? I can. We're ready to jump on to the stormwater system improvements. The only one that's on there that's not TBD is the extra road, and if we are going to follow that path, that's probably somewhere in that range would probably be somewhat expected for all the pipes under that street, because where we're doing it from Lafayette out to the 95, and there's probably quite a few pipes, so I have no comment on that line item.
Mr. Moore?
To be frank, I'm not even looking beyond 2013 in the CIP.
Okay. Anyone else?
I'd like to.
Mr. Nichols?
I got a couple. Winneconnet Road was kind of beat to death at the public hearing, so I don't intend to...
well, that's not what we're not on.
We're on the stormwater.
Right above it.
Oh, okay. No.
Yeah,
no.
Okay. And Mr. Bean, nothing? Okay, we want to move on then to Lafayette Road, Winneconnet Road.
Yeah, we can do that, Mr. Chairman. You want me to start?
Yeah, like
okay, I'll wheel
Mr. Nichols said, we've already really talked about this. So
yeah, but
keep it short.
I have something I want to bring up, though, real quick. In this letter dated 10-2 from William Rose to you, it indicates that the cost of this project may be available to cover the additional cost depending on several variables, including the amount of the increase. If the project bids had come in that doubled the EOPCC, we most likely would not authorize the funding. So now the question is, out in my mind, I had to look up in somebody's dictionary, it wasn't mine, what an EOPCC was. I found out that's an estimate of probable construction cost, the best I could do with that one. So the question is, what is the EOPC, in this, referring to this letter that you received from Mr. William Rose?
Again, looking at it in phases with these projects of these magnitude, of this magnitude, if you're looking at building like a new development, you can go in. You know, my father, an example is when I was growing up, my father was an electrical contractor. And he would say, you know, it's easy to give someone a price on a brand new house. I can give a competitive price to do the work because you know what you're getting yourself into. But he would never give anybody a price to go in and rewire a 200-year-old house because you don't know what you're getting yourself into. And a lot of these projects, and the reason I say that is that you got to prepare for the unknowns for these type of projects because you just don't know what you're going to get into, just like with the sewer system. I had assumed when I first took over this project that the sewer was okay because it was looked at 2 years ago, or, you know, the whole project. Oh, lo and behold, we have to replace the sewer. That's very typical of these type of projects. In fact, looking at Church Street, if one of the advantages in not trying to repair the old Church Street station is, mm-hmm. you know, all the unknowns, whereas now we're building a new station. Mm-hmm. So the estimate of probable cost comes in different sequences. And the first one is the engineer comes in and they do the first phase, which is the study phase. Mm-hmm. So they look at it, and they've done that. Now, they've given us a number of how much that's going to be. I think it's $440,000 off the top of my head. Don't hold it to me. I think that's what it is. But
so it's not the $250,000 that we estimated in the beginning.
Oh, no, no. And if you recall, I warned you 6 months ago that I was concerned with that initial estimate, you know, when I first came on board.
The EOPC looks like it's a firm number in this gentleman's mind when he sent you this email.
No, because then that's what I was trying to say is that you got your study phase where they give you a rather than a ballpark number.
Okay.
It's more than a guess. It's now they're getting some real numbers. Then you go into the preliminary design. Mm-hmm. You take that study, the information you get. We have the public informational hearing to get to include the community and, you know, their questions and concerns and to get feedback on input on the project.
Right.
And then they take that information and they start looking at numbers. And what they'll do is they'll look at similar projects in other areas of the state with recent bids to come up with a number. So that'll be the preliminary number. Then we go into preliminary design, and they start refining that number a little bit because now things are starting to hone in. But then in final design is when they really come down and crunch the numbers to give us a more accurate number.
Well, I follow that sequence. My problem is I don't follow this letter because this Mr. William Rose seems to think we will not fund it if it's doubled the EOPCC, like he thinks that that's some kind of a number that he can put his hands on.
Can I comment, maybe make this go faster?
Yeah.
I suspect that Mr. Rose, the number that he's using for the EOPCC is the gross $560,000 number, of which 20% is the town, or $112,000, of which $48,000 is already encumbered. So Rose is looking at the $560,000, not the $250,000, correct?
What he's concerned about in that letter is that if in the end we go, if the townspeople approve this project and we go into the design process, not even in the design process yet because we had to put a hold on the project until after the town votes on it.
Right.
But then that EOPCP, whatever it is, then you don't know the numbers until you go out to bid. So he's saying, well, say that in the end, after the final design, the cost is estimated at $500,000, okay?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And then we go out to bid. All of a sudden, we got five bids, and the lowest bid is $1 million. He's saying, I can't give you an open checkbook. So I can tell you that we're supporting this project within reason. But we can't just give you an open checkbook and guarantee that we're going to pay 80% okay. of whatever that number is.
But again, his reference point at the time of that letter is 560, not 250.
Correct.
Okay, that clarifies a lot. Okay. That's all I had on that one.
And Mr. Moore?
Yes, following up on some comments that Mr. Nichols made last week, I believe. And I think it was it possibly is the only way to get this thing moving. The question was, damn the torpedoes, full speed ahead, we do the intersection. We ignore what's in the ground underneath the intersection. How much additional cost would be involved if 3 years from now, or 10 years from now, or more likely 35 years from now, we have the money to replace the sewer lines on Lafayette Road. What Dick's question was, and I'm sorry, we do the road. Now we have to dig it up again at some point. How much additional cost are we talking about digging up to replace just that sewer line? I think Dick, I don't recall that you got a direct answer.
As a matter of fact, I was kind of saying, is it $50,000, is it $300,000, and, you know, I walked away from that thinking we didn't get an answer from Keith because he didn't want to make up some number out of thin air.
Well, I don't, but I will say this. It'll never get, it's going to only get much, much, much more expensive because the game plan at this point, if this report here to move forward, is that we would go to design, which we would get the number out of, construction estimate, and go to town meeting. And if the people support the project in general, then we would put the sewer out to bid with the concept that we would do the sewer work in the fall of 2014 and then do the intersection in the we'd do the sewer in the fall of 2013 and then 2014 we'd do the spring the intersection. So by doing it that way, we save money because typically if you go in and do a storm drain or a sewer project, you have to spend a lot of money for final paving. But if you do it as part of a phased project, we do what's called temporary paving, which is much cheaper. It's not as expensive. So instead of doing the more expensive permanent long-term paving, we get out of it now with the only temporary paving, so we're saving a lot of money by doing it that way, because then we're going to go back in there and just grind up the road anyway in the spring. But if after all is said and done in 10 years, we go back, it's all nice paving, nicely paved, and you got to do the sewer work, you go in there, now you got to do that permanent paving, because you got to make it, bring it up to the standards of the existing roadway.
Maybe, let me interject something for a second, okay? Because the pavement life is 15 years on the average. If you make it more than 15 years without having to replace the sewer,
then you have no incremental costs.
There's no incremental costs at all, because you're still going to have to repave. Doesn't matter whether you tear it up or not, you're still going to have to repave. You're still going to have to redo the project. So therefore, the incremental outside is 15 years. Probably 20, because you're going to pave to a slightly higher standard because it's an arterial roadway. So let's say 20 years out on the flip side.
I think we're taking a very big gamble with the intersection, with the surface portion of the intersection. If we go to the town meeting and say we need $550 for the sewer project, then I just think we're taking an awfully large risk.
Well, it would be the way it's been proposed. It would be one project at $610,000.
Yeah. Still going to have a risk on that one.
Can I add a little to that?
Sure.
The problem I'm having is I can't get my arms around the feeling of how big is the safety problem. I think we're probably solving a lot of it, the high end of it, and whether or not we're really doing anything in relation to the traffic flow. I think that that's an unknown. I listened to what the engineer said and whatever. Something that I thought was interesting, did anybody see the horrific accident in Pelham this weekend where the police car, the guy in an unmarked police car got nailed by a car that flipped? What was interesting is the article that went with that. Pelham's apparently got two intersections that are pretty bad. They're going to put roundabouts, rotaries, whatever in there. And what I thought was interesting is both of those intersections have had 30 accidents since 2008. I'm not sure if that means it's been 30 accidents over 4 years or three or four and a half or whatever. But my point is it's substantially more than what we're seeing at Winneconnet in 10 over 3 years, and even our high street is substantially more. I'm just, and by the time we're done, I'm going to throw some numbers in at Phil's point of the big picture, but I just don't think we're going to be able to do everything. And I looked at that and I said, geez, if all we did was tee off the intersection at minimal expense and not address the sewer pipe, not address the signalization, not address the theoretically the traffic flow, we would spend very small money, okay, in doing that and no longer have the conflict with the Tineos in and out aspect of, you know, on Lafayette Road there, or the contention with the area across the street. I believe a very, you wouldn't resolve all of the safety issues. You wouldn't help the pedestrians with, you know, the lights that would allow them to cross and whatever. But I believe that it may be, and I'm saying this as, I'm not trying to be a traffic engineer, I'm just throwing something out there, you may spend 5% of the money and resolve 80% of the safety issues without having the, you know, oh darn, we spent a lot of money on the safety issues and now 5 years later we got the sewer pipes. So that's my thought on that.
We're still on. Comments, Mr. Bean?
Just real quick, as the director stated in his initial presentation, there are two projects. One is subterranean, one is a traffic issue. I support the traffic issue and much less enthusiastic about the subterranean issue. Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Pierce?
Are we ready to move to the next permission?
Yes.
Okay. That happens to be the chair on the banana split with Lafayette Road in Winneconnet. I've talked to several people about the intersection over the years, and as much as I like it the way it is, I can see when you're pulling out of the spur on the Lafayette from Winnicunnet that you are in the quandary, because you got people coming out of the galley hatch, you got people coming down Lafayette Road, then you got the people coming out of the apartment buildings across the street, and of course you got people coming down from the north on Lafayette Road. To make it even more interesting, some people go up to the intersection and turn left, which I never could figure that out. But back to making this spur one way, that would eliminate all the things I just said. Have the spur angle off of Lafayette onto Winnicunnet one way. Now you're talking total cost, Mr. Bean, would be roughly one traffic sign saying do not enter one way and a little bit of paint on the asphalt, and we're done.
Okay, are we Last moving one. On to the Winnicunnet Road, Landing Road intersection?
That was it.
So that
That was me on that one.
Okay. So do you have any...
You were talking about Landing Road and Winnicunnet.
No, I was talking about Lafayette Road and Winnicunnet.
You were talking about Lafayette. Yes, thank you.
Lafayette. Sorry, I'm off okay. one.
So we're talking about Five Corner Intersection Reconstruction and Improvement Project.
You want to move with that one now?
Yes.
Okay. I'm all for that. I hate to spend $600,000 on anything, but having lived here in Hampton in a house that I bought with my own money and the banks since 1968, and having lived here since 1963, I've seen more accidents at Five Corners than any place else altogether in the town of Hampton. I have personally seen at least 10 accidents at Five Corners, and it invariably includes a car going westbound and hits a car coming out from the north side, either Little River Road or Mace Road. And the problem with that is, I don't know if they don't think stop signs mean them or what the problem is, but the car going westbound hits them and it ends up over in that fellow on the southwest corner's yard. And I think that's a priority item, because there have been more accidents at this intersection than at Winnicunnet, number one. And there's 22,000 cars passed through, somebody said the other day, on Lafayette Road per day. And we've had 10 accidents in, what, 3 or 4 years, and we have slightly more at Five Corners, but Five Corners has a lot less vehicular traffic. So if you look at the accident per car per mile, or however you want to break that down, there's no comparison. Five Corners is a disaster area as far as accidents are concerned. Plus, just for the rest of the board's edification, I hate traffic circles. But the one on Sagamore, south of Portsmouth, that has solved that problem. And it's attractive. And it's small. It'll fit where we want to put that, at Five Corners. So I'm all for the $600. I'm 100% behind it, period.
It's $600,000, not
$600.
Mr. Moore.
I'm totally in support of it, too. There's a lot of traffic accidents there. And I think the only reason we moved it from 2013 to 2014 was a bit of a concern over what the tax impacts in 2013 would be, and also concerned about whether the department could manage that project on top of some of the other things it was looking at. So if there's any change in the outlook on either of those issues, I could still support it going in 2013, but I'm not sure if the other two questions have been answered yet.
Okay, Mr. Bean.
I have no questions or comments.
Mr. Nichols.
No, I agree. I have nothing to add.
Okay, so
before I move on, Mr. Chairman, is there a possibility that we could switch Five Corners instead of Winnicunnet Road? Is that in the scheme of getting this so-called free money, which is not free from the state on Winnicunnet, and moving it to next? Some other year?
I think that's a possibility, but I think it would be premature to try and do that at this moment.
Okay.
Okay, you want to move on to the next thing?
Sure. You want to do Landing Road? There's nothing happening in 2013. I agree with Phil's observation. We got to watch the money because we're heading for disaster with this schedule. I don't know if that's exactly what he said, but that's the way I interpret it. And I think we can leave that off of my thinking completely.
Mr. Moore.
I'm not prepared to think about that intersection this evening, or perhaps the balance of this year.
Okay. Mr. Bean.
No, sir.
Mr. Nichols. Okay. Do you want to continue
And that gets us down to wastewater treatment plan. I think the director's done here is just tried to spread out some of these issues that need to be taken care of, and I think most of these, if I'm not mistaken, are to meet some kind of guidelines by the state. Am I not mistaken?
Correct. The town had an administrative order given to the town before I came on board with certain conditions for improvements at the wastewater treatment plant. So we're just trying to space those out. But really what I'm trying to do at this point is to buy some time with the state to look at the whole wastewater treatment plant as it, in relationship to the new draft permit, discharge permit that we could get any day right now. There's no doubt in my mind, historically, when you get those things, they require review because they're going to come up with new parameters that we need to look at. So my point with the state is, well, why should we go in there and make all these improvements when this pending permit's coming out, and that the possibility that those parameters that come in on that permit could change how we treat processed wastewater. So I've sent them, I think I gave you a copy of a correspondence asking if we can defer any further work other than the dewatering project that we are in the process of working on right now, mm-hmm. until we do this facilities plan, looking at the permit, looking at the whole facility, and updating the existing
So that's basically what you're saying to me, that if I'm interpreting right, you spent this smaller amount, 13, a little bit more based on what you plan to do now, but it may change for 14, may also change for 15 and 16, but you've still pushed it out over a period of time.
Correct.
Anyway, I mean.
Correct. We know what these improvements are.
Right now, but with the new specs for the discharge.
We don't know what those are.
That may change some of these numbers.
It's possible.
Yeah. So I think it's smart to go with down the path we're going on, those five steps, in fact.
Okay, Mr. Moore.
As long as the regulators are going to accept that amount of spend and keep you out of handcuffs.
Mr. Nichols.
I'm okay with the 90,000. The only question I've got is, this number has bounced around more than many. It started out at 100, it popped up to 350, it dropped to 150, and now it dropped to 90. Has the scope changed dramatically, or?
I've been talking, yes. The answer is yes, and that's with conversation that I've had with one of the regulators at DES on how best to spend our money, and she actually encouraged me to find that project and to narrow it down in scope a little bit at this point in
okay.
time.
Okay. That's
any questions, Mr.
That's
Bean?
So.
Okay, so did we want to have any closing thoughts on the CIP?
Did you want to talk about any of the rest of this stuff at all?
Well, I don't think there's anything.
No dollars there for 13.
Yeah, why? So.
Yeah, I'll make a closing comment on that.
Okay, just make a closing comment.
Yeah, well, then I will let. I won't say anything else. All the rest, I think we pretty well beat to death, but the items down below, when it comes to ponds, I think we have to wait and see. And the dam have to wait and see on that. We talked about that. So I think there's nothing else to be said.
Any closing comments on the CIP, Mr.
No, sir.
Moore? Mr.
No,
Bean?
Sir.
Mr. Nichols?
Yeah, a couple. One is, at one point, the Gristmill Dam project had a $500,000 number associated with it, and I think we shifted to a TBD, and we're looking forward to having a more accurate number, you know, after you spend your 25 or 30,000 or whatever it is on the engineering project. But just so you know, for the because that is so near term and it's something that we may be forced to do by the bureaucracy, I'm continuing to use the $500,000 number for financial projections until a better number comes along. Fully realizing that that number could be less than 500,000 and could be more than 500,000. To Phil's point earlier, and I could make him at the end of the Warren articles when we discussed the non-DPW, but I think I'd like to make them now so that Keith's here and has the benefit. And I'm putting some specific numbers in relation to Phil's comments, which he and I are on the same wavelength.
One of the things that I did is I took the forecast, which ultimately is driven to arriving at a number for the tax rate. And this is something Mike and I have worked on over a period of probably 3 years now, and it's now tied to the CIP and goes out to 2018, the same period of the CIP. And what I did over the weekend is I plugged in the latest input we've had as a result of finalizing the operating budget. The input that we got from Keith on his CIP is now plugged in there. The other input that we got from Fred in the form of the other are plugged into that, and some numbers fell out. I sent that. I would consider them preliminary at this point. I sent them to Mike. I helped Mike out. This is something Mike and I have worked on together, and I help him out by doing some of the work or whatever. I wouldn't consider it final until Mike's gone through it or whatever, but it should be pretty simple. And here's the bottom line of what we're looking at. The municipal or town portion of the tax rate with all this, that tax rate in the last tax bill, 2011, was $7.13. It looks like with a $400,000 overlay and using what happens to be $175,000 that's plugged in currently from the UFB undesignated fund balance, 2012, my guesstimate, I wish Mike was here, but I'll throw it out there anyway, is that it'll be about $7.32, or about a 2.7% increase over 2011. So that's not bad. I don't know if you and Mike have had any discussions.
No, we haven't had a chance yet.
But anyway, the proposed 2013 budget, where we basically ended up last Monday, coupled with the 2013 warrant articles, will drive an $8 2013 tax rate, which would be a 9.3% increase over 2012. And that's with the CIP as you sent it to us the end of last week. So it's 2.7% from 11 to 12, 9.3% 13 over 12. If I then take the impact of the 2014 CIP, I plug the whole thing in going out, but it's really only through 2014 that there's a lot of substance, the tax rate would rise to $8.68, which would be an 8.5% increase over 13. So from 11 to 12, 12 to 13, 13 to 14, you'd be talking 2.7 followed by 9.3 followed by 8.5. Part of that, which doesn't is not reflected in the numbers, is in Mike's spread, he's got a $2 million bond in 2014 that doesn't hit in 2014. So there's more money being spent than showing up there. That hits starting in 2015 at $179,000 a year. So we're also kind of mortgaging the future at the same time by bonding, which makes sense, 20 years, some of the more expensive stuff. What this works out to is a municipal tax rate that would increase by almost 7% compounded from 2011 to 2014. That's over a three-year period. Also have to point out that the above projections do not factor in any of the use of the UFB. And I'm not advocating that we use it, not use it, how much we use or whatever, just factual information it does not factor in. So it can be mitigated. Using an optimistic projection for the available surplus, UFB, at the end of 2014 of $2.2 million over and above the DRA recommended minimum, if you used it extremely aggressively, which I'm not advocating, but I'm saying how much could you really impact the 7% compounded over 3 years, you could drive that down. If you just split it between 13 and 14, you could drive that 7% down to 5%, just to give you a feeling. If you just kind of said, let's throw everything we got that's available in the UFB over and above the DRA minimum, which is about $2.7 million, you'd still be at a 5% level. And just to kind of try and put all of that in perspective, 2011, the average taxes on a single-family home were $5,700. If you looked 10 years out at the difference in the impact between a 2% compounded over 10 years versus a 5% compounded over 10 years versus a 7% compounded over 10 years, it's huge. $5,700 in 2011, 10 years down the road, 2% compounded would be $6,950. $5,700 in 2011, 10 years down the road at 5% would be $9,300 as opposed to $6,950. 7% compounded over 10 years on that $5,700 would be $11,200.
And that's kind of where we're sitting right now, at that close to 7% level. So that, you know, Mike has this. I suspect it's probably not a lot of work. I suspect he'll, you know, he usually finds some little things in there, but I don't think it's going to change the substance of the bottom line of the numbers.
Okay, did we want to continue with the warrant articles?
Other non-DPW.
Okay, yeah.
Well, we haven't really, we talked to CIP. Do we want to talk to warrant articles that have been then reflected in the manager's package from the DPW? Not that we need Keith to do that. There's some funding issues that are assumed in there that I have to say I don't necessarily agree with right now. So
I didn't change the funding from last year.
Okay, so do we want to go over those while Keith is still here?
No, I think we've got the substance of what we need from Keith. Now it's a question of
finalizing
what we want to do with DPW items, but then talking about the funding.
Did you have any questions, though, about the DPW warrants while he's here?
I think we covered, that's where we started off of 45 minutes ago in trouble.
Yeah.
I thought we were talking about the warrant articles. And
I noticed you were.
So we started with the CIP, but that feeds right into the warrant
articles. You were
articles.
Just trying
so
to get me to catch up. I know.
No, you were probably. I think that's what the chairman wanted you to do, so I was
in
error.
I think we're set with Keith. And,
yeah.
You want to stick around for a few?
If you want me to.
No, you can go home.
Yeah.
I think it's
a time
up to you. I don't think we need you, because we can argue really well about you.
How bad are you? Our agenda problem next week is that the manager's not here. Is that
correct? That's correct.
And the week thereafter.
That's correct.
Thank you, Keith.
And we want to get the warrant articles moving forward.
Okay, did you want to start with them?
I think we should. I mean,
okay.
I would like to go home. I
open
think
up and let's get
go
going.
Let's go.
Well, is that right?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Let me get this to me. We're going to discuss just financial ones, or you want to try to get as much of this through as possible?
I think we should limit the scope to financial. I think that's...
I'm fine with that.
Okay. You want to do them in sequence?
Well, with that as a... We're not going to discuss the ones that are not that do not have a financial impact.
The first one has money, is the old courthouse.
Yep. I'll start discussing, and I'm not going to be in favor of it, and I clearly won't be in favor of it if we're using undesignated fund balance to do it. If we want to go to a vote with the town, that's fine. I understand, you know, where that's coming from. But let's not use undesignated fund balance to cover it, because then we get a truer vote, I think. If people see no tax impact, then...
Yeah. Is the fund balance in that one?
Yes,
yeah, it is.
Written? Is
yeah.
it? Okay, I didn't pick up on that.
I question still, and with the most recent estimate that came from the manager back in early summer of $600,000 to...
I just didn't pick up on that.
...to refurbish the space, and I'm not going to ask him to defend that. You know, it's what it is what it is.
That's what the engineer gave us.
Right. That works out to be about $200 a foot.
And that did not include handicap accessibility or elevators.
Okay. Then it's something more than that. We have pressure at the library, which hasn't been mentioned recently, but they certainly a few years ago were talking about an addition that they would wish on their space. We have community service buildings that have been discussed. I think this might be an inexpensive way to address some of the need requirements that exist in town for space. But I understand if the selectmen, if the rest of the other selectmen want to put this forward to get a feeling from the town, I won't vote for it. But I would ask that if the motion that's made to draft this article finally, if that's what you wish to do, at least you're not taking the $75,000 from undesignated fund balance.
Okay.
So you're only talking about the demolition article instead of the renovation article.
I think you've removed the renovation article from the most recent.
I did because the board told me to.
I'm not challenging you on that.
No. I just want to know if you want to put it back in.
I count numbers.
I understand you.
Mr. Nichols?
I'm fine with what Ben suggests. Matter of fact, I didn't pick up on it when I read it. Phil just showed it to me, but I agree with you. From what I just read, I didn't pick up on it. I'm fine with taking the use of the UFB out of there, and I also am hopeful that by the time we get to the latter part of December, we've got
a much better number that's hopefully a lower number. Fred, you're doing some work on the asbestos.
We have just sent out a $1,200 contract to get the asbestos, the entire building checked for any environmental hazards.
Right, just because for what it's worth, the old town hall cost $22,000.
No, $2,200.
Yeah, it was low, very low.
There was nothing in it.
There was nothing.
No, no, the entire demo of the old town hall.
Oh, it was $22,000, $23,000.
Yeah, and this is showing $75,000 at this point. Obviously, I can see that the, you know, the courthouse is more expensive to demo than the town hall, but I'm just making the comment that I'm hoping we, in addition to removing the UFB, which I would support, that we're not seeing a $75,000 number.
I don't think we are either.
Yeah.
Okay, Mr. Bean?
The building's a dog with fleas, love to see it go, and I'd love to see it go cheaper rather than $75,000.
Okay, and Mr. Pierce?
I think that the consensus is we don't want to take it out of this undesignated fund balance.
That's fine.
I agree with all that. I think most of us do. And cheaper the better, of course, but I'm all for doing something. We've waited for everybody to come forward, many opportunities. We spoke to the public many times. We've asked some of Ben's favorite committees and groups to take it on, and they don't want to, from what the feedback I get. So I think it's time to come to an end of this issue. Let's do it and move it forward. Thank you.
Did you want to move forward to the next one, Ben?
Sure. The next one I get is the Public Works Capital Equipment. That's in the sequence that I have.
Mm-hmm.
I think what we talked about tonight is separating that into two articles, one for $190,000. And one for the Packer separately that we can then look at later in the year. And again, I would delete the reference of transferring this from the undesignated general fund balance.
Ask a question on that. Are you headed in a direction of not using the UFB at all for warrant articles?
Generally, I think we got this, you know, the Exeter Road question that we talked about earlier. That if we're going to be using it for anything, we ought to be trying to offset a bit of the cost, because Exeter Road has been something I think that we probably have deferred for 15 years. And when we had a road fund, you know, the road fund for capital, I think it was initially set up to cover Winneconnet and Exeter, because the town knew that those were going to be too expensive bits. And we carried that balance for a number of years. We've now used that down, admittedly, partially because of the Exeter Road situation, but I think we've now used that down to close to zero, or if not zero.
We don't have a lot of money in it.
Right.
Oh, the road.
So, yeah. So at this point in time, I'd like to think that we're going to, if we're going to have an undesignated fund balance available to us for use in 2014, when that sewer work along the section of Exeter from 95 into Lafayette, that might be a place that I could see it being used. But I'm not sure if I want to throw it at every warrant article that we see.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay. Other comments on the DPW road improvements?
I would just ask Mr. Welch, just for the benefit of the public, to just briefly describe the purpose of the undesignated general fund balance. And when we were discussing that, just briefly, a quick synopsis, please, sir.
It is a fund balance that contains unexpended appropriations from prior fiscal years. It is an amassed sum of money. It's already been taxed. At the end of the year, all existing appropriations go to zero. Any money that's left in the appropriation accounts goes to the undesignated fund balance. The selectmen, along with the town meeting, can appropriate that money under warrant articles, or the selectmen can use it to fund the overlay reserve for abatements and things of that nature. But those are the only uses that it can come
to. Or reduce the tax rate.
When you appropriate to an article, you reduce the tax rate.
Thank you, sir. In my comments, I would echo Selectman Moore's comments that, in general, I am opposed to plugging that into the warrant articles. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
And I'll echo that. That's all I have to say about that.
And I agree. Ben, did you want to go with the fire department capital reserve fund?
Sure. I think we're skipping one package, which is DPW road improvements.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
$300,000.
No,
I have no comment. I think we talked about it. That's going to be for engineering on Exeter Road.
Are we going to take it from the undesignated
No, that's my comment on that one's going to be pretty consistent. but I'd like to say that we're going to, ask the taxpayers to authorize the...
Any other comments over on this side for the DPW road improvement, $300,000?
No, I'll just let you know that by the time we're done, I'm going to make some comments at the end that have more to do with the bottom line than any individual article.
Mr. Bean?
No, sir.
I'd like to see it not taken out of the unfunded, undesignated fund.
There, Ben, you can move on to the fire department capital reserve.
I was happy with the use of the, or building up a reserve to help us pay for the fire department equipment. I'm not sure if 150 grand is going to necessarily help us in the, with, because I think we're going to have a truck in 4 years, not necessarily the HAZ material truck, but even another pumper, so. But anything that we put aside in the savings envelope is going to help us.
If you look, when I sent the spreadsheet to Mike today, I copied you guys on it, and that goes all the way out to 2018, and you'll see how, you'll get a feel for the figures in terms of how much that helps when the pumper comes along.
Oh, it will, for sure. You know, I'm very happy with putting aside. And if I recall, Mr. Manager, you've told me that, you've got the 1995 town meeting approved the capital reserve.
That is correct, sir. It still exists.
I'm okay with that, too, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Anyone else want to comment on that? Okay, moving on to the cemetery burial.
Looks good. Probably hasn't changed in a few years.
That figure will change.
Will change. The 15 grand, yeah.
Right.
When does that get finalized?
The end of the year.
So that's one of the last ones to go to the budget committee then?
Well, it'll go, but with a note that says that these funds will...
Understood.
...accrue to the increased sales between now and then.
I think the 90 grand, now, the 90 grand has been the same for a long time as well.
It has.
And if I recall correctly, the Chief Sullivan said that he was going to use a part of that for vehicles, or for one vehicle?
Yes, sir, he did.
Yes. So I have no problems with that one.
Me either.
Anyone else with the cemetery burial trust fund?
No.
Comments? Moving on to the police forfeiture fund.
We're all set with
and that one.
That's automatic.
And the TV origination fund.
The only one question, how are we doing with that, Fred, on the Comcast arrangement, so to speak? Anything at all?
That's kind of a different subject than Warren.
Yeah, this
well,
is a Warren
yes
article.
And no.
We're being frustrated.
Okay, thank you. I'm all set with the Warren article.
Anyone moving on to the, the comments about the human service agencies, the 170-651?
That is flat.
And these have all been confirmed that the agencies are not going to be requesting anything other than what they got
several
last year?
Several did. We told them they'd have to have warrant articles. They immediately sent us new letters saying that they'd stay with the existing
amount. Sounds good. So this one's good.
Any Thank comments you. On that from this side of the table? Wastewater.
Oops, missed the taxpayer.
Well, that's not a financial.
Oh, you're right. You're right. You're right. Thank you.
Wastewater study, $100,000.
Is this the INI or the...
Yeah, the INI study.
I mean, I haven't got to that, Mr. Chairman. Give me a second.
The INI
it's
study.
It's on the original, on the front.
It's the one right after the sewer connect fees that you talked about earlier today.
Oh, I haven't got to that one yet. Okay, go ahead. I'm here. Thank you.
Okay, and does anyone have any comments on that, the wastewater INI study?
We'll talk about its language, but the 100 grand is good.
Okay, any other comments on that? Moving on, what about the, we've already talked about the Lafayette and Winnicott.
Yeah, we pretty well beat that to death.
Yeah, but we haven't put it in the form of what we want to say for the warrant article.
You want to start with that?
I want to say no. How does that help?
Well, you do.
We understand your position.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Did you want to go on?
I think we got the staring at ourselves and saying, are we going to ask the town to take care of the sewer at the same time, or do the road only and not what's subterranean, or take care of it by putting up a, you know, repainting the spur and leaving it like it is and letting the Fed money go elsewhere. I think that's the three paths we have to look down.
I believe as I look at, I'm looking at a spreadsheet that calculates this tax rate that I talked about earlier, and I don't believe that you can go ahead with that Lafayette road when it kind of with the sewer and the whole bit without implicitly you're going to end up when you add up the numbers asking the voters to support a 7 or an 8% increase. I mean it's
so
at,
what are you suggesting?
What I'm suggesting is that when we're done going through these, I'm going to look at this. Okay, I'm telling you the process I'm going to go through, and I'm going to say,
geez, 2.5% is probably a reasonable number of what inflation is going, and any time we go higher than 2.5%, we're digging deeper into the taxpayers' pocket. I find it painful to dig into the taxpayers' pocket deeper than 2.5%. That doesn't mean we can't ask them to do that, okay? But it becomes more and more painful as we go to 4 and 5 and 6 and 7 and 8, okay? And I'm not going I'm just not going to, you know, recommending something that actually is a 9.3% increase over 2012, and this is the first thing at $610,000 that I'm seeing there. And I see that the only way we're going to get down, I think we're going to have to go to asking more than 2.5%, don't get me wrong. But the only way we're going to get down from that 9.3% number is by addressing some issues in a much less expensive manner or not addressing them. And I believe that this is of all of them, based on the size of the appropriation and the opportunity to do something without spending a large amount of money that we can impact.
So what's your position?
I guess my position on this is, and I hate to do this because I'm kind of acting like a traffic engineer, so it's, you know, it's kind of dependent on getting some feedback from, you know, Keith of the engineers, is to consider just simply teeing off the intersection, getting rid of that spur, spending short money, and resolving what appears to me to a major portion of the safety issues almost immediately.
Well, that may bring up some other issues. But one of the suggestions I made to Keith the other day was that there were two significant failures in the pipe that he identified, and he talked about here in front of you, according to the survey that was done by televising the or picturing the inside the pipeline. And my suggestion to him was fix them.
Fix those two.
Leave the rest alone. And then do the intersection. And one of the reasons I suggested doing the intersection was that in just teeing the intersection and not putting up a traffic control device, you basically have the same intersection that you have on 107 in Seabrook, which has the highest accident rate in the state for traffic crossing multiple lanes. And that's what you would be doing coming out of Winneconnet Road. Because of the backup of traffic, what you're doing is you're squeezing between two vehicles. If there happens to be a lot of vehicles in front of you, and there should be in that situation, going north, coming out of Winneconnet Road, you may or may not see the vehicles coming down, and they come at pretty high speed. If it's a car, some of them whiz through there pretty quick, you're going to have a bad accident because you're trying to squeeze out between motor vehicles. That's what makes the highest accident intersection that we have in the state, and that's located on Route 107 in Seabrook.
It has got a huge set of traffic lights there, though.
Well, the huge set of traffic lights is a problem. It's always a problem when you put traffic lights in. You've got multiple intersections that are very close together.
Yeah.
You have multiple turning movements, so much so that a rotary or a rotary type device won't work at that location simply because of all the turning movements you have coming in from various locations.
I think Fred may have come up with a good solution. We've kind of been round around this, but what he's basically saying is, I'll put some words in your mouth and then you can throw them back after
okay.
If they're wrong. What he's basically saying is we do the $112,000 piece, okay, in terms of town expense, okay? We've already encumbered 48,000, that's so we're only talking 64,000, and that we go in and fix two of the sewer pipes out of operating.
Absolutely.
Two of the sewer pipes out of operating and move forward, and we've leveraged the 446,000
in federal
money.
And quite frankly, if we do that, we don't maybe, we'll have to look at the financial projections, but we might be able to do that ourselves if we have the proper authority and the proper leftover spending this year.
It's possible.
But it does present you a problem, because you've said in previous meetings that you wanted this intersection to be something that the town voters voted on. If we do it if we had the financial wherewithal to do it within the numbers that we're already authorized to spend,
mm-hmm.
we can take care of it, not worry about, or excuse me, not go after the full rebuild of that line. Hell, we've known about this since 1989. They did this 23 years ago, and they said these same issues that was televised last week were there. With
a couple of exceptions.
And I think the other thing that I'm concerned about is that from an I&I standpoint, it could be that there are still areas in town, at the beach, as an example, where the I&I potential is much higher than it would be for this particular section of sewer on Lafayette Road. Yeah. I'd still like to get the intersection done, and it could be that if we just take away the sewer discussion from this,
fix the two pipes out of operating.
Ma'am, Mr. Chairman, the architect of this two-paragraph work is a genius. I think that's Mr. Welch's, perhaps Mr. Moore's. The director said it is, echoing Mr. Moore's comments, it is a two-issue problem. The second paragraph on Lafayette and Winneconnet, I fully support Mr. Moore's go-ahead that it'll only cost $64,000 just to deal with that traffic light and fix out of operating what's below. So I would encourage us to strike that second paragraph and leave this just as a traffic issue and leave the subterranean alone.
Now the question becomes, we seem to have a consensus on that approach. Do we go forward with a warrant article or just do it?
And
both of those, I think, are options.
Just a minute. We may have a majority on the consensus, but it's not unanimous on that. I think we can spend less than $1,000 to definitely improve the safety at that intersection. Compared that to any amount of money that you mentioned in this warrant article is just not the same.
Okay, well,
do you remember
we seem to have a consensus.
Do you remember the Ford Pinto and the lawsuits that existed over its design in the 1980s?
Yes. It was cheaper to let people sue.
And the engineers at Ford made a decision that it was cheaper to let people sue. I don't want to be the engineer on the Pinto. I'm not sure if I would be prepared to say that let's spend $1,000. I understand where you're coming from, and I understand that spur causes us issues. Because when you're trying to turn left there, your head's doing a 360. I think from a safety standpoint, that I would just as soon go ahead and try to do the intersection the way that the engineers are now saying it should be done. It'll be more expensive, but perhaps it'll be a longer-term solution than the barricades or the painting.
So we have an 64,000, not 610,000.
So you're going to change this warrant article to drop off the sewer part, right?
Well, that's what we're talking about.
Yeah, I got that part. And so what are we asking the voters to approve then?
Well,
we're going to ask them to approve doing it.
64 grand would be one.
It's the $64,000 question.
And, or, if we believe we have the statutory ability to do so ourselves without violating the Municipal Budget Act, and, more importantly, if we have $64,000 of unexpended budget authorization.
Do you like that approach, Mr. Nichols?
I like the approach, except I like the idea of putting the $64,000 warrant article out there, simply because God knows what everybody's reason was, but it has been turned down in the past.
And quite frankly, there's not going to be any construction that happens on this thing between now and the March vote anyway.
Right.
So
I tend to agree. We ought to put it on a ballot for that, just if nothing else to get.
So
to
we
approval.
Have a consensus there. Okay,
yep.
We're moving on.
Yep.
Okay, so does that mean we're at wastewater treatment plant facilities? Mr. Moore.
90 grand.
Yep.
Let's.
We talked about that earlier.
Keep the process moving forward.
Does everyone agree with that? We have a consensus. Construct sewer and drain building in Wash Bay, 500,000. We've talked about that. What do we feel?
I think that there were questions asked of the Keith this evening that ask him for what the change in values might be if it was reduced from seven bays, I'll call it five bays, down to something less than five bays for trucks.
I think we're
doing pretty good tonight, actually. We could push that one off until Keith gives us a number. And we could do that while the manager's away, I think. We could make that decision without screwing up things too much.
I think there are a couple of things he didn't mention that I think you ought to know about. I think he intended to mention it, but he was getting too deeply into the detail. there are several pieces of equipment that we're required to keep online year-round with water in them. There are also several pieces of equipment that we should be garaging that has sensitive hydraulic equipment on them, and we're not doing any of that. So we really need...
Can we survive without being garaged all these years?
Well, they have to be emptied.
Huh?
They have to be emptied, which means you've got to go fill them again. If you get them outdoors. I mean, when you have a sewer backup, you need your equipment to straighten that backup out. That thing is on call 24 hours a day. It's like a fire truck. It's got to be there. The equipment you have, these loaders for the wastewater, trash, they should be garaged. They're sensitive pieces of equipment, and they can freeze up, and you don't want that to happen.
Yeah, the sidearms, for sure.
Yeah. And this garage space could be used for some of that.
Mm-hmm. Let me ask a question while Keith's doing his research to look at the downsizing. Could he also give us a price for just a washdown by itself, just to give us a ballpark?
I could have him do that.
I'm not going to support that.
I didn't say you would. I just said, can we have that information?
And I'm not going to support it either, and I think that
I would just point out that when we get to the bottom line, which we're not going to get to tonight, but I think once Mike does his thing with the numbers, I think we're all going to see things a little bit. For example, I did some quick calculations. What started out at 9.3 by virtue of getting rid of the 546 in the sewer takes our 9.3 and drops it to a level we're still at 6.7. So that was good. I mean, that was a pretty good jump, but I think there's going to be a dialogue where we're looking at those numbers.
Do you have any comments on that?
I think the idea of let's not say one way or the other, let's see what...
Okay, so we want to move on to the new ball fields.
Now, where's Campbell Park or whatever it's called?
Campbell Road is...
Property.
The Campbell property is next to the James House. It's off of Toll Farm Road.
Way out in the booth.
Did you want to go there, Ben?
Well, we need more facilities. The Campbell property is actually... I've never walked the Batchelder property that was proposed as a second location or another location for these playing fields. I presume it's next to the pond there that's off Toll Farm
as
well.
It's the school lot.
It's school property, which is the first issue. I don't even know how you get back into it, where you build the road.
You would have to build a road down around the back side of the pond of Toll Farm Road.
It seems like the access to the town property that's called the Campbell Farm, off Toll Farm, would be a much easier site to build playing fields on. It's fairly level. It was used for agricultural purposes up until when the town bought it. So it's not going to be it's going to have cost. I presume it's going to have $1 million of cost.
$1.011 million.
Yep. I think the town has this need. The playing fields here are used a lot, and that's from the one off Hardock Way to the ones at Tuck Field, to the ones at Eaton Park. Because the schools don't let their fields be used very much for non-school athletic programs, so all the programs are running on town facilities. So I think we need something. I'd love to see this become a volunteer project. I'd love to see us throw, community spirit into this and not absorb the entire $1 million, of course, but to try to get the people who are using these fields, the softball teams, the parents of the little warriors, the parents of the soccer kids and whatnot, to get involved in making some of this happen. I think we have the need, Dick. The question is, can we afford it? And I'd love to see a part of the monies that come in from town parking devoted to this type of a bond.
Other comments on this issue? Mr. Bean.
I would love to see the Hampton school system and the Winneconnet school system open their doors up in a more gracious way to the denizens of Hampton. Very few people make the cut to play varsity sports, and it's an excellent program. However, the gym was $5 million. That football field is gorgeous. The baseball fields are gorgeous. Those are predominantly unused and underutilized by the taxpayers of Hampton. So I would look to that before we address more recreation to the tune of seven figures in the town of Hampton. Thank you, sir.
So you're against that?
Yes, I am, sir.
Okay. Mr. Nichols.
Yeah, I have a little bit different take on this. One is I've talked about this a little bit with Diane. As a matter of fact, one day I was down at Winneconnet walking the dog, and Diana was there, and she had one of her programs going. And we got into a little bit of dialogue of the rec department's ability to use the schools, whether it's Winneconnet or whether it's, you know, Hampton Academy or whatever. And I got the feeling there was actually a pretty good relationship there in terms of the schools letting Diana use them for the rec programs. I think what might go on is she might have all the time in the world to use them during the summer once, but maybe very little time, you know, once school is going. And when I've seen her, like, for example, the time at Winneconnet, it was during, you know, it was before the sports programs at the schools, you know, got started. So I'm not sure about that one. To the flag football field, I don't, and again, it may be a seasonal thing, but I can tell you from, like, May to recently, that's not used much at all. It may be heavily used as you get into the fall or the spring. I'm not sure. But the flag football field is empty most of the time from my observations from May to now, for what it's worth. I think to Ben's point of being funded in a major way, I'm using major way, I don't think he did, by methods other than the taxpayer, I agree, and I think this is one of those, sometimes when people say, you know, we got to give the taxpayer, we should give the taxpayers to the choice, let them decide or whatever, I think that this is the kind of issue where you let the taxpayers decide. It's not like something where you get intimately or whether you need a, you know, a wash bay or a garage or whatever. They know what this is about and whether they want to throw their money or whatever. But I think, Ben, do you, $1 million translates starting in
80 grand a year.
What's that?
80 grand a year.
101 a year.
What rate, what interest rate are you using?
This is in Mike's projection. I think he's probably using something.
It's like about 5.5%, perhaps.
Oh, I don't think he's using anything at all that high. I don't know. I'm looking right at his spreadsheet.
Mathematics, but 25%. If he's using 3.5%, it would be an 8.5%. Hit, so it should be somewhere around 85 grand.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm looking at a spreadsheet at 101. Okay. Either way, it's in the same ballpark.
Yeah.
In terms of your thinking, like other, I mean, do you think this is something where maybe the, you know, it's a Warren article and the town proposes some small percentage, like 10 or 20% of that, or what sort of, what am
I haven't a clue. You mean how you would then?
I know.
How you would then make volunteer effort happen to reduce the cost? No way. You know, you'd have to almost have commitments from groups of people who say, we will either, you know, fund, or we'll get out there with our rakes and we'll rake the fields.
Maybe,
out, you know,
maybe
whatever.
It's got to be put out to the volunteers first.
Maybe.
And have the volunteers try and organize something and come back, much like the way the skate park, park went.
It can be done in phases. I mean, first of all, you need access. So, you know, you'd be using some DPW heavier equipment. I'm not sure. I had a very brief conversation with the manager regarding how you would go about designating a portion of those parking fees to pay for a bond, and there was no, in our short conversation, there was no clear answer that an RSA existed that would allow that. So it would have to be a year-by-year voter choice, I think.
That's correct.
Okay, so what are we promoting here for this Warren article?
I think we're going to gather more information on this.
So we're just going
to
gather more information.
I'm not ready to go ahead.
To be determined.
Yeah.
Okay, the recreation office space, Tuck Field.
That's to be determined, too.
So that's going
to
be predetermined.
More definitive information.
Okay, the total appropriation request, $4,038,486.
Yeah, but we didn't agree on all that, so.
No, you didn't.
Let's have an update of what we've.
You'll have an update this week.
and the total revenues and bonds available. So...
I'm sorry, I'm not following you where you're at now.
I'm on...
He's reading off the bottom of the memorandum.
Gotcha.
Does anyone want to discuss that?
What page are you on again? I'm sorry.
He's on a summary, I think.
No.
No.
Appropriation request by article. I'm on the one that was in our sheet tonight. And then...
And we're going to go through the non-monetary ones after we've gotten, is that going to be December? Are we going to try to get some of those done in November as well?
It's up to you folks. Do them right tonight if you want. Some of them are done non-controversial, like...
This is supposed to be a two-hour meeting. We're at 2 hours.
The budget article.
Yeah, this is supposed to be a light meeting. We're
going... Well, there's going to be a lot of warrants coming along later, and I know of one especially, so unless you guys want to stay later, we can, it's okay with me to put them off. I know we're going to have more.
Oh, yeah, sure.
More.
Yeah, we are.
Mr. Moore.
So...
No, town. I got one in my pocket that's coming.
I believe we've covered the...
Everything.
The money warrant articles, at least those with tax impact.
So we're going to cover the others later, is that what we're saying?
I would just leave it with you that I think that we're still up at somewhere in the vicinity of a 6% year-on-year increase, right. 2013 over 12.
So do we want to go to closing comments for this discussion? Mr. Nichols?
No, I think we've said it.
No, everyone's...
I got one.
Ben. Mr. Moore.
I think part of the reason is that there was very small tax impact in 2013 of the CBAs, and we're certainly going to see that fully in 2012. We're going to see them fully in 2013. I think the board collectively over the years has been very successful at managing that tax rate. There might be some, there might be some issues that are going to cause that to look a little bit higher than inflation. I'm not suggesting that's what it's going to end up as, but I don't think we can't kill ourselves. And you said it earlier tonight that we might not be able to manage it at 2.7%.
Oh, absolutely.
Higher than that. So that's my
point. My point, just so I'm clear, is that it doesn't mean it would be too rigid to simply say it's going to be 2.5%. That's ridiculous. I'm just suggesting that at the extreme, I know I couldn't go along with 9.3, and every percent you start going above that 2.5, 3.5, it becomes more painful, and I think you have to look harder at things that you might not do. That's all.
I'll move to adjourn.
One thing.
There's always somebody, Ben.
Yeah, I know. Just the law of averages, right? You approved a pig roast for Wally's Pub for last Saturday, which was the 7th.
It's actually the 13th.
It is now going to be the 13th. Now, he did not have the alternate date on here, so we told him he's got to come back for a vote. So the board has to approve it for the 13th. Same arrangement. Just be this coming Saturday rather than last Saturday.
What's his timing? What's the timing?
It's 12 hours. It still begins at 8 a.m. for, and they're talking about all the prep and everything, and it goes to 10 p.m.
So he's competing with another event.
He is.
What was the other event?
Seven Walk.
Very good, Mr. Nichols.
The thing is, this is the time that they usually have done it. I think
there is no competition with...
I don't think you're gonna... Are you having Harley's for the tavern walk?
I'm just making a statement.
Come on, Ben, say something.
I wanted to get the free plug in.
He has better weather on the 6th than he might have on the 13th. If he's looking for weather, he might go until December.
The way it all unfolded, I had a feeling it wasn't quite right because it didn't make sense with the way they were trying to run around to get it done.
Do you need a motion on that, Mr. Manager?
Yes, sir. I would need a motion for you to approve it for the 13th.
I will make that motion.
Is there a second?
Sure.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Already signed. He hasn't signed.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
You have
all of that?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yes, there are things to be.